All right, so tonight we have, as our guest, Marc LeBlanc. You may or may not have heard his name.
It's a crime and an oversight because he is one of the most influential speakers and teachers, as some of you discovered today, as well as designers, developers, and programmers we have. He's been involved in some amazing projects, starting with Blue Sky, which turned into Looking Glass. We have a fan. Excellent. I first met Marc back in 92 when he was finishing up his MIT master's degree and playtesting games, like Ultima Underworld. Became a full part of the team on Ultima Underworld 2, and we'll obviously come back and talk about all these later. Worked on System Shock. Wow, you can barely see all of that. That's excellent. Okay. Critical member of the team on System Shock. Worked in some capacity that I don't actually remember on Flight Unlimited, so we'll talk about that. Worked in some capacity on Terra Nova that I also don't remember, so we'll talk about that. Obviously a critical member of Thief. I remember that
I was very
vividly.
Critical of Thief.
Yeah, we will talk much kidding. About that. System Shock 2. Deus Ex, though we gave him a special thanks credit, which was probably appropriate, but we really do owe him quite a debt. Again, he came in and playtested, and with about 10 words, sort of helped us out immensely. Thief 2, then mysteriously went to Visual Concepts, where he worked on sports games. Okay, one of these things is not like the others, Mr. Rogers. And from there, thank God, came to his senses, went to work at Mind Control Software, where he worked on Oasis. This is him with Andrew Leaker, winning accolades, acclaims, and awards. They have also worked on Field Commander for the PSP. This is awesome, man. This is great. And then many casual games that I have to admit I haven't played, so you're going to have to carry the ball when we get to those. I just downloaded R, which I cannot wait to play, though it seems to have an interesting core dynamic, which we will talk about.
Sure.
And again, as I said, he is a teacher, lecturer, writer, and secret master of gaming of some, well, renown, I guess, is the wrong word if you're a secret master. But anyway, so that is Marc LeBlanc. So... the structure for that, actually, I'm going to go back to the beginning. Okay. The structure of this evening is going to be a little bit of interview, a little bit of lecture, a little bit more interview, breaks all where you'd expect them, and a little bit of Q&A. So store up your questions. All right. So the first thing I'd like to talk about is... where you're from, both literally and figuratively. What in your background prepared you for a career in gaming?
That's a good question. I guess I started making games.
Oh no, I'm gonna go back much further than that.
Okay. Oddly enough, I was an only child. I had nobody to play with. That wasn't literally true, but like I didn't have any family members to play with. You know, I had guys down the street and stuff, but like. Oddly enough, I didn't play a lot of games, per se, as a really little kid, because I just, like, friends down the street weren't necessarily interested in games, and, you know, I don't know, there was a lot of, like, solitaire play of little games found in magazines and stuff that, I didn't have a lot of that, experience as a really little kid, you know, you know, when I was around in junior high, or actually a little bit earlier than that, that's when like sort of the sort of wargaming D&D craze actually hit, and people like who were like it was actually almost cool to play D&D and stuff like that, and that's probably where I got my first sort of gaming experience. Like right around sixth grade is when I started having friends who like were gamers, you know, and I played a lot of Steve Jackson metagaming games.
Yeah.
Steve Jackson was my hero, and you know, some D&D, that kind of stuff. D&D group at the Wenham Public Library. The Wenham Public Library had we played in a jail, The Wenham Public Library was the old town hall, and it had, we played in the cell of the original Wenham jail from, you know, 1650 or something.
Excellent.
And yeah.
That was around the same. Okay, when you started playing
a literal dungeon.
When you started playing board games, electronic games were already pretty much a happening thing, right?
Right, right.
So were you an equal opportunity gamer, or was it all board games all the time?
Well, it was. There was a lot of digital games once I got access to the computer, which was about in sixth grade. Okay, in sixth grade, our elementary school got its first computer. We had one computer. This was back when the principal's office did not have a computer. No one used a computer. Like, we were getting one computer. It was an Apple II, and I was one of 14 kids of the whole school of 500 or so who was allowed to use it. And because it was just the sixth grade, the really smart sixth graders were allowed to use the computer at first, and then, you know, they would let other people in and stuff. And I remember the first question, when they told us they were going to teach us how to program, the first question I asked was, can we make our own games?
Excellent. You're already thinking about that.
Holy right. Cow. Right.
So was that the point where you transitioned from being just a player to being a creator? Did you immediately start, like, making Ultima knockoffs on the Apple II? Or?
Well, I played a lot of games on the Apple II. So much, it was a little weird because no one knew what these computer things were. Like, the teachers had no preparation. Like, none of the teachers knew really had any computer experience. And so they didn't really know how to treat it, and they didn't really know what you were doing with it. So if you, and weirdly, our advanced math kids, like, could just, like, take a pass and go and use the computer anytime, any class you were bored with, whatever. You could just, like, if the computer wasn't being used, you could go and use the computer for whatever. So I'd, like, cut classes and play Apple Trek, you know, and stuff like that, because they just had no comprehension, which meant that they eventually did get comprehension, which meant I spent a lot of time, like, banned from the computer. But while I was banned from the computer, I would be, like, writing out basic code in longhand, you know, like, in preparation for the moment when I would, you know, get, you know, unbanned from the computer. I'd be like, start typing. And I remember there was a particular history project that I, you know, tried to write. It was like for, War of 1812 or something like that, sixth grade. I tried to write a little, Age of Sail, Constitution versus Guerriere sort of simulation, and I wrote it out longhand in BASIC in pencil, and was still never got to type it in because I was still banned from the computer. I tried to give it, a friend of mine agreed to type it in, and he was expecting, like, you know, this 20-line program, and I was like, okay, here's my 6 pages of, you know, code.
That was
for
probably
this.
Like 6K or something.
yeah. And he was like, no, I'm not typing this in, forget it. And it was full of typos. And I mean, like, you know, I'd been writing code longhand with no compiler, no interpreter, no machine for, like, that long. Yeah, so that was my first experience. The first game was actually probably in seventh grade. You know, I did a Lunar Lander clone, and then I did a, like, fly through the cave clone. No, actually, the very, very first game was a Steve Jackson melee thing where you had two actions that you could take in the game. You could fight or you could run. You know, and it used, like, the metagaming fantasy trip system to resolve the fight and stuff like that. You know, it made to hit rolls and did that. But those were the only choices: fight and run. And if you run, you ran, you went, ended up in another random room with another random monster with which you could fight and run.
That was always a system that I thought needed to be on the computer because I've told Steve this, so it's not like I'm telling tales out of school.
Right, right.
But he always creates the most amazing role-playing systems where character creation is just robust and fun and fantastic.
Right, right.
And then you get into combat and it's like, just grinds to a halt. Like a 15-second combat encounter takes you 3 days to play out.
Right, right.
But on a computer, it'd be great.
Sure.
So
it was.
I might actually want to play that someday.
No, it was terrible.
So cutting classes, spending all your time, like, making up games for that you could type in or not on the Apple II to MIT.
Well, I mean, I was a huge Infocom fan. I was a huge Infocom fan, like, when I was in high school. You know, the Zorks, the Planet Falls, you know, those kinds of things. And I knew those guys were an MIT startup. Like, so I had, like, deep, like Steve Moretzky and Marc LeBlanc were, like, my heroes. And sophomore year in high school, I wrote an Infocom game, basically, in BASIC. And I actually wrote a better parser than most Infocom games have. And I did all this fancy parsing of the English language. And I got really interested in that problem of parsing the English language. And I took my English language parsing game to the state science fair, where it won like a second place or something. And the state, which was awesome because the state science fair is in Massachusetts, where it's held at MIT. You know, so I got to sort of like bask in the glow of my heroes, which were these Infocom guys. And I actually sent them some printouts from my game, saying like, if you ever need a tester or somebody, you know, like look at my qualifications. I made this game, and I never heard back from them.
Have you ever told Steve Moretzky that? I mean, Steve's still around.
I don't know if I told him that story about. I think I have told him the story about sending him the thing, but. Yeah, well, it's interesting because that got me interested in artificial intelligence, which was big at the time. Everyone was sort of this attitude that we're sort of just on this cusp of this, you know, someone's going to invent this philosopher's stone, and then all of a sudden, like, you know, computers are going to talk back to us, and they're going to, like, you know, realize, and they're going to turn the world into an Arnold Schwarzenegger movie, you know, and stuff like that. That, you know, everyone thought that AI, strong AI, Turing test surviving AI was just around the corner. You know, it was just, there was some little algorithmic trick that we were just missing, and we're going to find it one of these days. And, you know, the sort of parsing the English language thing was very interesting to me. I went back to the science fair the next year. Oh, that was the one. That was the one that won the second place. The first one was just an honorable mention, but the game was just an honorable mention. The other one was just like sort of a thing that could talk reasonably about, answer questions about sort of taxonomy of animals. And I used animals as an example, but it's sort of like you would tell it things and it would learn and then it would like make inferences. So, you know, you could say like, could ask it if, you know, do dogs have hair? And it would say yes, because dogs are mammals, and mammals have hair, you know. And it would like I used the taxonomy as sort of like the database of stuff. But my interest in the game turned into sort of this interest in AI and programming. I was always interested in the programming, but like I started learning real languages for one thing. Like I went from BASIC, went straight from BASIC to Lisp, and then. And then, yeah, so I did the second project in Lisp, and then there was some class at the school was taught in Pascal, so I learned Pascal just to get an A in that class. And, you know, so, and I learned some C and some Prolog and some Smalltalk and, you know, not much assembly. I sort of learned assembly, but there were, like, some basic concepts of, I tried to, you know, write assembly code in the, on the 6502, but there were just some basic concepts I didn't get at the time. I really didn't understand the idea of an addressing mode or anything like that. And those ideas on the 6502 were, I think, a little bit squirrely anyway. So, yeah. What was the question?
I don't even remember. okay, so let's jump ahead to MIT, because I find when I started working with the Blue Sky team on Underworld, I had expectations about what an MIT student was like.
Right.
And what a team composed largely or comprised largely of MIT students would be like. And I was completely confounded and joyously confounded.
Right, right.
And so I'll get to a question, I promise.
Sure.
No,
that's good.
What I noticed that surprised me was how well-rounded MIT students are. At least the ones I've interacted
sure.
with.
Sure.
And how real world oriented, at least you guys were, uh-huh. to the extent that there is a kind of an entrepreneurial thing that you want real world applications for your stuff, and there was an approach, and I'm wondering if this approach was part of why the programmers and designers I've worked with who come from that culture are actually different and maybe better than many of the other people I've worked with.
You flatter us.
What, sorry?
You flatter us.
I do. It's true. Well, it's all deserved. But there seems to be an approach at MIT where you approach computers from the hardware up, Right. And not from the application down.
Right, right. MIT is one of those schools where the computer science department is in the electrical engineering department, as opposed to those schools where the computer science department is in the math department.
And so did that influence the way all of you guys like write your code and think about how your game should be implemented?
I think so. I mean, some of it was a sign of the times a little bit. Back when the underworlds were being made, there was this new thing called the 386,
I just had an SX.
It had, yeah, they didn't all have floating point, which was terrible. Some of them only had simulated floating point. One of the big issues was extended memory, right? There was, because the original, one of my things is, like, if someone gave me a time machine, what would you do with it? I would, like, go back to Intel and IBM and tell them that their, like, PC architecture was gonna last decades. You know, that, like, believe it or not, someday 640K will not be enough. You know, that was in the growing pains of... I'm sorry to get technical on you non-technical folks, but that was in the growing pains of going from machines that had 640K to machines that had more than 640K, but the basic processor like really could only deal with 640K at a time, or maybe a meg at a time, so you had to do all kinds of tricks to you were basically doing swapping and things like that. In your RAM, because you didn't, so you had to contemplate writing a game that fit in 640K, and it could occasionally go out and touch, more memory, but, like, it had to, and so there were, we were very hardware constrained, I think, back in the DOS days, where there was no virtual memory and there was barely memory to begin with. So, yeah, I do think that there is definitely that influence. I think that MIT does, they do give you a lot of perspective into the sort of hardware angle of what's going on, as opposed to a math-based computer science curriculum. MIT also has a math-based computer science curriculum. It's just less popular. Tim is a math computer scientist, actually.
That's why he's a designer.
That's why he's a game designer.
Right.
Exactly.
Okay.
Absolutely.
But speaking of Tim, that's Tim Stelmach. One of the things that also amazed me about Blue Sky, later Looking Glass, was how strong and coherent a culture it had. Now, that's not to say that you guys all got along all the time.
No, absolutely not.
Screaming at the top of people's lungs,
right, that's
very
part of that.
Frequently. And I'm wondering, I want to talk about the toxic and inspiring culture of Looking Glass in a minute.
Right.
But did you guys really all meet at a dorm? I mean, it's like Doug Church, Dan Schmidt, John Mayara, Tim Stelmach, James Fleming, Moby Games is your friend. Go look him up. Critically important guys in game history, and all from one dorm, right?
Well, here's the real story. There was a guy at MIT named Paul Shawcross. I don't think you will ever find his name anywhere in Moby Games, maybe not. And he had a friend named Mark Sobkowitz. And Mark Sobkowitz had an uncle named Paul Neurath. And so Paul Shawcross used to run a D&D game at MIT, and he would invite his friends down the hall on 4th West, where people like Doug Church lived, and also would invite his high school friends like Mark Sobkowitz. And right around the time, that was happening, Mark Sobkowitz mentioned that his uncle was starting a game company just as Doug Church was leaving MIT for greener pastures. That's how that connection got made. And after a giant long chain of nepotism, right, like that entire, not that entire floor, but like, that's how James Fleming got pulled in, who lived on 4th West. And this is a hallway at East Campus, which is a dorm at MIT. And at that dorm, James Fleming lived there, and he got pulled in, and John Mayara got pulled in to this company, Blue Sky. And then one of the girls in Fourth West had a boyfriend named Dan Schmidt who got pulled in, and there was another guy on another floor of the same dorm named Tim Stelmach who got pulled in, and eventually I got pulled in, and then I was actually kind of like a little bit of a nexus because you know, those people were kind of like too cool to be like real gaming nerds, and I was like the real gaming nerd who I spent a lot of time with the MIT Assassins Guild, which was the MIT Live role playing group essentially, and the guild is really unlike anything I've ever seen anywhere else because the games they run are 10 days long and involve 90 people. So like I've never seen, and over the entire campus. So I've never really seen, like, I've seen live role playing games before and since, but I've never really seen that particular format anywhere else. But anyway, I digress. And so that, you know, and then I pulled in people like Rob Fermier, who pulled in people, you know, who pulled in some other people. And the rest is kind of history.
And then, so many of you all went to work at Blue Sky.
Right.
And many of you ended up living in the same house.
Yes. Right?
Deco Morano. Why don't you talk about
the house of 10 dumb guys.
Yeah.
There were a couple guys at Looking Glass there was three guys at Looking Glass who lived in the same house, or two of them and some friends who lived in the same house. And it's cold there. There's snow and stuff in Boston. And you have to, like, actually buy this fuel that runs your heater, you know, so that you don't freeze to death and stuff like that. You have to, like, order the heating oil sometimes if you have oil heater. And there were these three guys, and they had forgotten to buy the heating oil again, and they were, like, shivering in their cold house, and the phone rings. And one of them picks up the phone and says, "House of three dumb guys." And then later, like, when they move, they get a few more people, and it becomes the House of 10 Dumb Guys. And then the House of which is a bunch of Looking Glass folks. Not Looking Glass. It was Blue Sky back then. And the first floor living room of the House of 10 Dumb Guys became this playtest lab for Underworld 1. That one right there. And then there was this bizarre... Then the landlords of the original House of 10 Dumb Guys got divorced and started fighting over the house. And so the House of 10 Dumb Guys got sick of that and decided to, like, form a little coalition to buy a new house. And I lived in that new house.
Right.
Which was the House of 10 Dumb Guys, which half of Looking Glass lived at.
It was pretty amazing walking in that place, I gotta say. I saw my first Chia Pet there.
There you go.
And had my first hot Mountain Dew with marshmallows.
Oh, yes, hot mulled Mountain Dew.
Yes.
That was an East Campus thing back from MIT. That we had a pretty gross sense of humor back at MIT.
It was pretty great. And all the machines were named. I remember that. I had to name my computer before you guys would talk to me.
Right, right.
And let's see. James Fleming's computer had been destroyed by Wing Commander 2.
That was
my first experience at that house.
Right, right. Yeah, the naming thing is actually pretty interesting because, like, at MIT, there's long before a lot of places did, there were, like, these big computer rooms that, like, any student could go to and just use a computer. They were all Linux boxes. They were all on the internet. And they all had names like, you know, M1-132-32, which was, like, the building and the room and the machine number. You know, that was, like, the domain name of that machine. So, like, if you were, like, a department or you were, like, not one in one of these clusters, then you could name your machine. You had to have a domain name for your machine, and you could name it whatever you wanted. So, like it was kind of almost like this status thing at MIT to have a machine with a name instead of, like, this indecipherable string of numbers. And so, people would be very careful about naming conventions, right? Like, oh, in this lab, all the machines are named after science fiction authors. Oh, and in that lab, all the machines are named after Alice in Wonderland entities. And, you know, and it was... It was a status symbol at MIT to have a name. So, like, you know, we sort of carried that forward. You had to name all your machines.
I just brought my 386 SX16. It was a
smoking flamethrower laptop at the time.
Man, it was. It was awesome. And it weighed about 40 pounds. It was great. I lugged it around on the plane and called it Elmer Fudd, Elmer PhD. That was, if you ever see Elmer PhD online, that's me. There you go. Hey, you know, I was into cartoons. What can I say?
Still is.
It's still. Okay, so looking back on this, the whole MIT Decamerono looking glass culture, it was toxic and inspiring. And I mean, people screaming at the top of each lung, at their lungs, constantly each other's throats, and yet, great games came out of that struggle. I mean, is that the way you felt at the time? Is that an accurate assessment of the culture?
Yeah. No. I mean, it was very youthful and energetic, right? And it was basically an extension of, you know, sort of in many ways an extension of a particular MIT campus culture where. Everyone just assumes that you're kind of smart, and so like one of the big things was like whoever did the work first got to decide how the work was done, right? Like that was a big part of the culture. So it was all about sort of like, you know, it's all about sort of fighting to have your vision and not the other guy's vision realized in some way. And it wasn't adversarial in that way. It was just like sort of a collective. A collective ambition.
It always seemed like it was driven by passion and respect. And,
right.
And again, as you say, the assumption that everybody is really smart and wants to do the right thing.
Right.
And out of that, I mean, it's just incredible to me. And I think to some extent I've spent the last, you know, 15 years trying to recreate that somewhere, somehow.
Well, I think you need a time machine on some level.
Well, that's the implicit question.
Some of it has to do with like the time and the place that like a group that size and that inexperienced could make games like professionally because the hardware was where it was and the tool chains were where they were, and you know, you could make a game with a mere $250,000, you know, and
that's like a week.
Yeah. And you know, so some of it was that, and some of it was just like, I mean, it really was like the college startup energy. And I think that if you like find other college startups, like actual ones, like not even making games, but making things that people are passionate about, I think that there's a lot of training. I can't speak for all campuses, but I think that there's a lot of training that, you know, like if you have an opinion, you're supposed to, you know, rant and march and protest and, you know, write letters to the whatever your newspaper is, and you know, just generally and decorate your door, and you know, whatever, you know, you're like, it's very much a sort of like speak out and, you know, express your passion kind of culture, like at that level, you know. And some of it was just like, hey, we were really young, we had like nigh unto infinite stamina, like we, you know, we were really passionate, like we didn't know what the heck we were doing, so like, you know, we, you know, the alternative was to be loud, and you know, and it worked.
So have you, well, two questions. First of all, have you ever read Warren Bennis's work on great groups?
I have not.
You should. It's great. You should too, by the way. Warren Bennis on great groups. Again, the internet is a wonderful thing. Look them up. So have you left that behind personally? I mean, are you still trying to find that again, that passion, that group, that adversarial thing that leads to greatness?
I think that, you know, there's a sort of constant struggle to keep the well full, I think, now more than there was when I was just a kid. There's some stuff that I will gladly leave behind, like I feel like I have ways of communicating now that I didn't before. Like,
use
like
your words.
Some of the, you know, I mean, it's basic psychology, right? You shout when you feel like you're not being heard, right? Like, and so like, the real message is like you're struggling to communicate, right? And so like, I remember a particular argument during System Shock with Tim, where, like I wanted to we had made some decision, and like I wanted to communicate that like we had just been talking, it's Tim and I, and we had come to some conclusion about something that needed to be done, and I kept trying to reiterate what we were saying. Like I would just say, so what we're gonna do is, you know, blah or whatever, and I don't remember what it was, but like he wouldn't let me say it. Because like to say it was to imply that he didn't understand. Like he wouldn't let me say it because like to say it was like an insult to his intelligence, you know. And you know, and you know, and I've been in that situation. I had been in that situation with Tim too. I mean, like, it's not like Tim's, you know, a dumb jerk. It's that, you know, like, we were all dumb jerks. And, you know, like, I think that, like, there are ways to, like, to communicate to someone that you want to, like, err on the side of over-communication, and it's not an insult to them, like, but you like to have that, you like to have that certainty that you're on the same page. And so, like, that particular incident sticks in my mind. It's, like, something that, you know what, I don't need that anymore. And, you know, it's, you know, it's, and whether, and the fact that it, that comes with, like, maybe some, you know, some lower amount of energy or stamina or something, like, you know, that's just, you get what you pay for.
So, you've been making games for a really long time. You've obviously worked on, well, 15
right,
years.
Right, so. Right.
You've worked on a huge variety of games at a variety of companies. You've experienced $250,000 games and mega crazy $1 million games. Where do you feel most comfortable? Are you a big company guy? Are you a little company guy?
Well, right now I'm a little company guy.
Yeah.
You know, I think that, you know, there's a lot of that at there's a lot of that sort of looking glass energy at Mind Control. Not all of it. Some of it is like Andrew Leaker, who owns Mind Control, is very talented, and has, you know, and he and I kind of think alike and unlike. He allows me to, like, shoot him down, and he allows me to, like, get passionate about stuff and get angry and things like that. And I think that that's really valuable. I certainly, like, today's games are so big, you know, that there's so little inertia. Anyway, so there's so much inertia, I say. There's so much inertia. There's so little, like, agility in terms of, like, oh, my God, what would we do if we had to, you know, if we had to change something? You know, what would we do if we had to, you know, for example, kill off this character because, you know, the voice actor just quit, you know, or something like that? What would we do if we, you know, like, there's so little room to maneuver these days because the production schedules are so long and the budgets are so big and the pipelines are so deep, you know, it takes so long to even get an asset in the game, that, you know, the small game experience is pretty charming with that regard. Like, these days I'm working on games that are smaller than System Shock by a lot in terms of scope, but in terms of RAM footprint, about the same. You know, like, you know, like look at a game like Ultima Underworld, and, like, look at, like, see if you could install it and see how much disk it takes. It takes like 10 megs on disk or something, right? Now go download, like, Peggle. That's like 30 megs or something, you know? It's like, and Peggle's a tiny game compared to Underworld, you know? But, you know, so, like, in some sense, there's sort of, like, in small games right now, there's kind of like an embarrassment of riches. It's like the tools, the machines are so fast. Like, you know, a modern computer can process the hell out of Tetris, right? The machines are so fast, and they have so much resources that you really can just, like, throw stuff together really fast and iterate really quickly, and that's pretty charming, I find.
So, okay, I'm going to go back to Looking Glass in a minute, but for all the roles you've played, mm-hmm. And you've been a critical resource on a bunch of games. I mean, Thief wouldn't be the game it is
right.
Without you. System Shock, not without you. Underworld 2, at least, not without you. And yet, you haven't actually officially had that project director title, you know? Not that I can recall.
No, I mean, I led a project, a short project at Visual Concepts, and this is sort of like going to the raison d'etre of going to work on a sports game company, but, like, there was a brief period where I was sort of, like, the creative and technical and everything lead on a project. It was just a prototype. It was basically me and 5 artists and, you know, an Xbox dev kit and, you know, making a prototype over about 6 to 9 months, you know. And kind of starved for resources because, you know, that's not a lot big team to make a little prototype, you know. And you know, but doing the game I wanted to do. And they didn't pick it up after the prototype. But, like, that was my only real experience. Actually, I was project leader on the engine team for Thief 3 for the duration of the engine team for Thief 3. And so I got some experience with that, but that wasn't really a game project.
See, I'm wondering what that says about the nature of authorship in video games, because again, those games would not have been the games they were had you not been there in the roles you played.
Right.
So I'm wondering if you know, if this is a role you even aspire to, or does it matter? I mean, it's almost like a who cares sort of thing.
It is kind of a who cares sort of thing. Absolutely. One of the jokes at Mind Control is that I'm not a game designer, I'm a game redesigner. Like, I'm not the guy who comes up with, like, your good high concept for the game. I'm the guy who, like, recognizes what's good about your high concept and, like, turns it into, you know, sort of, like, the lovely little nugget of fun.
And that completely reflects Deus Ex, just say a couple of words, things change. And without going into detail, because Disney will, you know, do the satellite laser strike on me, we talked a little bit about the game this weekend, and with just a couple of words, it's like I three times this weekend I went, oh my God, why didn't I think of that? You know, it's a remarkable talent.
Some of that is just distance, right? I mean,
yeah, some of it is, I'm sure. So do you think we have already seen a Marc LeBlanc game, or will we see that?
Oasis, in many ways. I mean, it's an Andrew Leaker game too, definitely, but like, there's a lot of my smell on that game.
More than I needed to know.
I hope you, I mean, I think Oasis is one of those. I think that in a lot of ways, and I think that Andrew would have no problem with me saying that. I think that I have back of the pocket things. You know, there's a AAA game or two that I hope to do someday. You know, that's sort of like, and it has a lot, and it's a lot like the one that was canceled at Visual Concept. But there are certainly like, there are certainly things that Marc LeBlanc games that I hope exist in the future. Let's put it that way. And in a funny way, the game design workshop that I run at the GDC is the Marc LeBlanc game. It's like a game about games. It's like the game of getting other people to think about games, kind of thing. It's almost like a little Shatner reprogram the simulation kind of thing. I did that once before at MIT, at the Assassin's Guild, right? There's we play these games, and we play like seven of them in its heyday. There were like seven of them a semester. Like, there was like seven of them a year, two each semester, and then there was IAP, which is like our January break, which it's actually January elective time, but there's two each semester, and there's summer, and there's IAP, and there's between finals and graduation, there's a game. And these were 10-day games, right? And like, there was one sort of honorary title you could get in the Assassin's Guild, which was the title of Master Assassin. If you played really well in a game, then the GMs for that game would nominate you for the rank of Master Assassin. It would go to the sort of the next meeting. They'd vote on it. There'd be deliberation. They'd send you out of the room. They'd vote on it. And then if it passed, they would vote to make it retroactively unanimous, so your feelings wouldn't be hurt. And so, you know, I never got nominated from any of these games, so what I did was I changed the rules for nomination so that you could be nominated by public acclaim rather than from the result of any particular game. And guess what? I got nominated. And I got named Master Assassin. So that was my other sort of pulling a Shatner moment. It wasn't really intentional. I really, you know, thought it was, I really thought it was like a better system, like, but it also, coincidentally.
You know, it's funny. Actually, one of the things I most enjoy about spending time with you is that you do game every system.
Oh, right.
Including,
right.
Like, life systems, you know?
Right, right. And I was explaining to him how to do certain expense report things that it hadn't occurred to him, for example.
Be very careful around this man. You know, he takes that Master Assassin thing very seriously and applies it to all aspects of his life. But Yeah, I think that's one of the qualities of all game designers and developers.
Sure.
I mean, I kind of have this pendulum where sometimes I run the company guy and sometimes I make the game guy.
Right.
And in those moments when I, or those moments that stretch on for years and feel like eternity, where I'm run the company guy, I often describe that as the game I'm playing now is the run the company game.
Sure.
I'm sure my employees and employers don't appreciate that, but...
Well, as long as your objectives are sound, I think it's fine.
Yeah.
Like, when your objectives are, like, actual success for, you know, for the company as opposed to, like bizarre self-aggrandizement. Like, if you're the one of the kind of the people who plays SimCity so that you can sort of, like, you know, torture your citizens and, like, you know, hit them with disasters, then don't use that particular set of gameplay objectives on your company.
Okay, so...
Not to name names.
Not going there. We're going to roll into individual games here in a minute, but I want to sort of take a little step back mm-hmm. and talk about philosophy for a minute.
Okay.
You have said... I'm going to probably misstate this, but you have said many times some variation of, I hate the word fun.
Sure.
Okay. Why?
It's just... Well, two reasons. It's vague... and it's sort of like it's vague, and it's like this trump card that like allows people to turn their brain off, right? Like people just want to say like you can't intellectualize this game, like you can't tell me why I like this game. It's just fun, you know, or like I can't tell you why I like this game. It's just fun, like, and that's like the end of the discussion, right? You know, like, or, you know, and so it's kind of like this trump card. It becomes this trump card. It's vague. It doesn't really help. You know, it doesn't really help you, like, in a meeting, like, decide whether to choose this feature or that feature, because they're both going to be fun, or maybe not. Or what if one of them's fun for half the people and the other one's fun for the other half of the people, like, you know. So there's that. And then the other thing is that it kind of, like, makes, I feel like it makes game design too mystical. You know, it becomes this humanistic mystery that, like, people can't, I guess this is part of the trump card thing. It's like, there are people who sort of believe that there's a spark of fun that can't be defined and can't be talked about. There was another reason too. Oh, the other reason is because like it limits our ability to think about games as just purely objects of entertainment. Right, like it limits our ability to think about, like, what if someone set out to make a game that was cathartic? Would that be fun? Like, I don't know. But you know, like, if we get past fun, then we can start to really think about, like, not, you know, I hate to use the term serious games because I dislike that one almost as much. But you know, we can think about games that sort of serve other aesthetic purposes. And maybe even, you know, if we stopped saying the word fun, maybe people will, like, start to think about games as not being just kid stuff.
Well, when we were talking this weekend about Senet, you were telling me about things about this
right.
ancient game that I knew nothing about.
I know the game, but I didn't know the Senet, S-E-N-E-T. It's one of the two top contenders for oldest game in the world. So you should know about it. It was played for 3,000 years, so you should know about it. But this is a game that started out as a pastime in Egypt in the 3rd millennium BC, and was played until about 1 BC. And it started out as, it's basically the precursor to backgammon, although I've looked and I haven't been able to, no one's been able to talk about the actual causal transition, or the, like, no one's been, I haven't seen anyone show that backgammon came from Senet, but ancient precursor to backgammon, and it starts as just a backgammon game. You got guys, they move around a track, you know, there's like this notion of blocking and hitting and sending guys back, and all that stuff you see in backgammon. But over time, the spaces of the board start to get names, and they start to have names of things like gods, Egyptian gods, and things like that, or events that occur during the passage through the underworld, which is what happens when you die. You get on Ra's bark, you go through the underworld, and you undergo these 12 trials in the 12 hours of the night, and I may get my Egyptology wrong here, I'm sorry. But if you make it all the way to the end, then you become one with Ra, and, you know, that's sort of like their heaven. And if you don't make it, you're just annihilated. And so this game starts to come to represent, the fiction of this game becomes that journey through the 12 hours of the night, and different spaces start to become like different trials and events that occur during the 12 hours of the night. And eventually, this thing becomes an oracle, that this game takes on religious significance. People are starting to play this game solitaire as a way of prognosticating what their 12 hours of the night are going to be like when they die. And to the point where, you know, every great pharaoh has one of these game boards, you know, one of these game boards in their tomb, you know, like, in order to help them through that 12 hours of the night. And over time in the cave paintings, the tomb paintings, over those 3,000 years, the Senate goes from a game that appears in the daily life scenes to a game that appears in the religious scenes, and it goes from being a two-player game to a one-player game. And it's like the tarot, except with ultimate stakes. It's like people were playing this game, as far as I can tell, to prognosticate whether they were going to go to heaven or not. And like they thought they could change the outcome of whether we're going to go to heaven or not by playing this game, which is like, I mean, I don't know anything that started as something modest and entertaining and become that. I mean, obviously there are books that will purport to tell you how to get into heaven, for example, but they were written for that purpose, right? I haven't heard anything that was a book that was like written to be some guy's fun story about stuff and turned into, you know, how to get into heaven.
So fun is kind of an inadequate word to describe that.
That, yeah.
And the concept of fun makes it easy to characterize games as being just kid stuff, waste of time.
I mean, I think there's that. I mean, we're living through a little bit of the sort of comics code thing, right? Where like, you know, where everyone just sort of assumed that comics were about funny animals and superheroes, and so when it came time to come up with a rating system, they came up with one rating, and it was called G, right? To quote Scott McCloud, and you know. I mean, we're running into similar stuff, right, with things like censorship and things like, you know, whether we're going to get the props we deserve, you know. Yeah.
So you've actually substituted something else for fun. I mean, a taxonomy of
right,
fun.
Right. Well, I mean, it's a straw man, yeah.
Do you want to go through that now, or are you going to talk about that?
I don't remember if I'm going to talk about that later, so we can go through it now.
Let's do that. What do you substitute for fun?
I have this thing called the 8 kinds of fun. Which is just a sort of top level. I talk about play aesthetics which are just sort of like the desirable emotional content of your game, right? It's what you're trying to make the player feel are like the aesthetics, and that's sort of like the pointy-headed academic word which encompasses not only fun but anything else we're trying to make the player feel, right? So it could be catharsis, or it could be a sense of religious enlightenment, or whatever. So just sort of as a straw man, I have this taxonomy of 8 kinds of fun, which, okay, now I have to remember the list. Oh, thank you. So there's...
Don't look at any of the other questions.
That's fine. There's sensation, which is the idea of game as sense pleasure, just all the ways that games are just regular guy art objects. They can look nice, they can sound nice, they can smell nice, whatever. I also lump into that sort of like the kind of visceral pleasure that games give you just as a roller coaster kind of thing. And then there's fantasy, which is the idea of game as make-believe. Just the idea that a game can be about something, right? Like it can be about, you know, going into a dungeon and killing Onyxia, or it can be about flying an airplane. And I make that separate from narrative, which is the idea of a game being a drama that unfolds over time and has dramatic tension, because there are lots of examples of games, like the fiction of chess is not very, very thin anymore. Like, well, people who play chess don't really think of it as this game of intrigue and conquest. They mostly think of it as this game of chess. But at the same time, you can talk about us, you can tell the story of a chess game. Right, you can tell the story of like the attacks and defenses and the sort of mounting tension and the moment and that climax, that moment of realization where it's like, oh, I'm defeated, I should resign, or I should play it out a little bit and then I can resign. And so I think that narrative really is separate from fantasy, even though we lump them together a lot. Challenge is just the ability of the game to be an obstacle course, to provide you with problems to solve, with skill, with ways to use your skill to like overcome just challenges. And there's a little bit of drama in challenge. There's a little bit of a cycle of I sort of confront the obstacle pushes back, and then I do some feat of skill or whatever, and I overcome. Then we have fellowship, which is just all of the social, my top level of all of the social pleasures of play. The ability for a game to be cooperative, to be competitive, to be like a social hierarchy, to be just an excuse to talk, to be an opportunity for trade. All of those things where it's like, hey, you're at home with your family and you're playing a game for the purpose of like having something to do together. I sort of lump that all into fellowship. Discovery is sort of the ability of a game to be like a space for you to explore. And there's sort of a cycle of discovery too, right? Like you come to a new place and you're a tourist and you're sort of looking around and there's lots of new stuff and you're looking at all and it's all interesting. And eventually over time you sort of learn it and you like become the master over that. Like after a while you're in the same space, you become the guy who people ask for directions, right? Like, so there's sort of this pleasure in like not only discovering, but also sort of becoming, gaining mastery. And that applies, I think, not just to spatial spaces, but also to like virtual spaces, like, or abstract spaces, like sort of the tech tree in Civilization is something that you can explore and discover and become a master of. All of these things are on my website if you don't want to take notes. Expression is the ability for a game to function as a vehicle for self-expression, for making a statement about yourself, or perhaps even for just exploring, you know, who you are. And then finally, the last sort of oddball kind of fun is called submission, which is just sort of like the game as being sort of a system that tells you what to do. Like the pleasure of turning your brain off and letting the game be the thing that prompts you what to do. Like the pleasure of knitting, right? Like you know what's gonna happen when you're knitting, but it's you don't have to make a whole lot of decisions. Like you just get to do something and pass the time and sort of be part of the knitting system. And I think that there are situations in games where like you're playing solitaire and yeah, maybe you're solving problems, but really it's just sort of like the pleasant activity of sort of moving cards around and, you know, in some ways, like the way in Tetris, like it's just sort of like the way that Tetris is like reorganizing your CDs, right? Like there's like something fun about like, oh, you know, just like the sort of like monotonous task of like getting all your CDs back into alphabetical order. It's just like this nice, relaxing, pleasurable thing. And Tetris is that same sort of cleaning, kind of organizing kind of thing. So, and these are sort of, I sort of see these as like the top level of the taxonomy. I sort of see those as like the phyla of the kingdom of fun, you know, that, you know, and I also see them as a straw man. It's sort of like it's an existence proof of getting past fun, you know. It's just like, I don't expect that like you're going to use those eight things, and I don't expect that any, you know, that those eight things are complete. It's just like, you know, if you're stuck, or if you're going to try and convince me that there is no such thing as like getting past fun, then that's my refutation. And people come up to me and say things like, "Hey, I found a ninth kind of fun. You got to put it on your list." And it's like, well, that's not the point. It's like, you know, it's like, no, you found ninth kind of fun. Put it on your list, right? Like now you should like take ownership of it and, you know, make your own sort of model, aesthetic, you know, vocabulary and framework, you know.
So clearly, every game is not going to embody all eight of those in the same proportions.
Yeah, and it's not like, you know, more is better or anything like that. You know, we've joked about how, you know, could you make a game that's eight cough? You know, has all eight kinds of fun. And
I gotta think about that.
It's not like more is better, but it is. But it's not like. It's not like, you know, any game delivers on just exactly one either, right? Like games are like these interesting blobs of pleasure, right? These interesting blobs of play that like some games are more challenging than they are dramatic. But other games are more dramatic than they are challenging. You know, some games are social and not challenging at all. Like there's a game like Charades is like it's challenging, but the challenge really is like this conceit, you know, that, you know, is there to sort of get you all together and interacting, I feel like. So it's sort of an it's not to imply that it's like a grand unified theory, but in some sense like a collection of little theories that, you know, can be applied in parallel.
So I find the eight kinds of fun concept really appealing personally. I find it appealing intellectually.
Mm-hmm.
Are there practical applications for this? As a designer, when you start to think about a game, or when you look back on earlier games you've worked on in preparation for starting to think about a new game, what do you do?
I don't think of eight kinds of fun as implying a process.
Mm-hmm.
Or being necessarily part of a process. I don't think like there's the eight kinds of fun checklist where it's like, you know, I haven't thought about challenge yet. Well, actually, I think there is a little bit of that. I think there is a little bit of like...
I think you're underselling it.
I think there is a little bit of like early in games, in a game, like I've written design documents where I've said, these are going to be the aesthetics of the game. And I've gone down that list and then I've refined like, oh, I'm going to talk about what the challenges are going to be. You know, I'm going to talk about, you know, like what specific kinds of challenge, what classes and genii and species of fun are going to be in there. But I don't necessarily think of it as implying a process, but it's, of course, it's all about communication too, right? It's all about like, you know, when you're talking to someone, like, I think this game, has problems with its challenge, with its challenges, like actually being able to sort of talk about specifically what aesthetics you're sort of struggling with and stuff like that, or doing well with. I think that that's just as a day-to-day sort of communication vocabulary, I think that it's valuable.
Now, I think we may be heading into a break here. I'm gonna sort of leave that up to you.
But I wanna
ask one more thing.
Uh-huh.
You do the game tuning workshop every year at GDC.
Right, since 2001.
One of the most valuable things I've seen come out of that in the form of papers that have been read widely and have had some influences, the whole idea of mechanics, dynamics, and aesthetics.
Right.
You talked about aesthetics here, and the eight kinds of fun kind of feeds into that. Some
right.
of the other others of your taxonomy fit into the other ones. It seems like this might be a good time to give people a break, segue into the lecture portion of the evening, if you're up for that.
Oh, you want me to start the lecture? Or?
Yeah, I'm thinking so.
Okay, sure.
So why don't we take a little break,
okay.
And we'll talk about mechanics, dynamics, aesthetics, and the game Oasis.
Right, stuff. Great.
Okay.
Okay, am I live? Great. So this talk is called Intuition and Intellect, Deconstructing the Design of Oasis. And I believe I gave this talk first at the Game Developers Conference in 2005. 2005 was the year after our game Oasis won Game of the Year at the Independent Games Festival. So here's what we're going to talk about. I'm going to give a demo of Oasis, and then we're going to talk about this sort of distinction I made between intellectual and intuitive game design. I'm going to outline an intellectual framework that I use for talking about game design, and then we're going to do a little deconstruction of this game, Oasis. And then I'm going to bring up some moments during the design of Oasis where we sort of found that our sort of intellectual process and our intuitive process came into conflict. All right, so now I'm going to very quickly give a game demo. Has anyone here played Oasis? A couple of you? Keep your hand up if you played Oasis, like, because I asked you to an hour ago. No, okay, that's fine. here's Oasis. Hopefully we won't have too many frame rate issues. Start a new game. Okay, so I'm just gonna play on normal. Alright, there's some story. So here I am, I'm the Scarab King, here I am. And I've returned to my kingdom and discovered that it's covered with this inky black fog. Okay? And so I need to explore my kingdom and sort of rebuild it before the barbarians come and try to destroy it. So I have 85 turns, and each turn is just a click of the mouse, right? And so one of the things I have to do with my clicks of the mouse is I have to explore. So you can just explore next to me. Now when I'm exploring, you'll see that I'm gaining followers, Okay, each place that I arrive generally has some followers, and it's adding to my pool of followers. And in fact, you can see they're following me around. Right, there's little follower guys following me around, little things hitting each other. So one of the things you'll see is that there's this, one of the things I need to do is find my cities, and cities are always surrounded by crops. So this is a square that's green. It's kind of like seeing a one in Minesweeper. I know there's a city nearby. There's also a couple question marks which show me that there's interesting things around on the map. And so I'm gonna guess that this question mark actually corresponds to this city. So I'm just gonna go and search over here. Oh, and look, it does. And it's got 39 population. Right, okay, so I'm gonna try and explore over this way and see what's going on. Oh, it's crops, so it looks like it's another city. Okay, so now that I have a couple cities, what I can do is I can connect them with roads, and that's good because that's going to help them grow in population, and it's going to help me sort of have an infrastructure that lets me defeat the barbarians when they come. So just to build roads, I just click on places I've already explored, and each road costs 5 followers. Now, we have never specified in the fiction of the game what it means that each road costs 5 followers. So you can decide for yourself what happens to the followers, whether they're gainfully employed in our new Department of Public Works or something else. So one of the things about cities are always surrounded by crops. And so one of the things is that if I search this square right here, all right, it's gonna tell me that there's no city anywhere along here because this would be actually a different color of crop to indicate that it was surrounded by more than one city. So I know that I don't have to search anywhere around here because, like, there's no city. So I'm gonna search down here. That's the oasis, which is also important, but I'm gonna leave that alone for the moment. I'm gonna keep searching. Okay, now here there's a place. It's like seeing 3 ones in Minesweeper. So there's a city here or a city or there. So I'm gonna try this way. Oh, it wasn't that way, so it's this way. So I'm just going to hook it up. All right, sometimes I'm playing with the keyboard, sorry. And so I need more followers, so I'm going to explore over here and then get enough followers to get the 5 to hook that up. Now, here's a mountain. Mountains are good. Well, they're bad because they're impassable, but they're good because they have mines. That's a mine. That's a mine. Oop, barbarians coming in 50 turns. That's a mine. Okay, mines are good because I can use my followers to mine them. So if I click on a mine, I just put 10 followers in, and there they go, and they start working in my mine, and here they are, in fact, and you'll notice that every time I click, they'll do a little digging, right? I'll make some more miners, and some more miners, and so every time I click, they do a little digging, and now that there's more, they dig faster, and so when they get to this little bow and arrow, I'm going to receive bow and arrow technology that upgrades all my cities, and then they'll start digging towards a new thing. So now I've gotten the bow and arrow, and now they're digging towards the helmets. And so once they're done with that, I'll get helmets, and that's good. So you want to get your mines early so that they have turns with which to work. So here's another city. I might actually explore. Oh, and another city. Oh, well, all right. Pretty much has to be like that. So you can see here there's a crop that's between 2 cities. And when a crop's between multiple cities, it looks darker. So can you see that that's darker? Yeah. I'll just connect those. That's good. And, oh yeah, you can see that my cities are trading now. They have little guys walking down between them. And in fact, in a couple turns, let me do a couple turns, you'll see that these cities will grow in population every 5 turns. See? Oh, those 2 grew. And that depends on how many are connected. So here's another thing that I need. I need to explore the oasis. Okay, the oasis has an obelisk in there, and it has a little glyph of power. If I fend off the barbarians, then I'll get to keep that glyph of power. If I don't, then they're going to destroy the glyph of power. And either way, I'll go to the next level, unless I totally lose the game, which is unlikely. Either way, I'll go to the next level, and I'll get a chance to earn another glyph of power. If I earn all 12 glyphs of power from 12 different levels, then I win. If I don't earn a glyph of power on a level, then I just have to try again. Well, I just have to try to get it again on a different level. So you can play more than 12 levels and still win. So I'm going to just keep exploring now. So there's only one more thing really left to find. Now I can think about whether I want to spend all the followers to hook the city all the way up here. And it's going to be, it's 5 times 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. It's going to take 40 followers. And that's a little extravagant. I think I'd rather have those followers as miners. So I'm just going to...
go. I'll grab five more. This is a special five follower spot. That's also a special five follower spot. That's a three follower spot. So I'll put some more guys in there. So there's another thing I can do is that I can also search my cities for treasures that will help me defeat the barbarians. And to search a city, I just click, and it uses one of my clicks. And instead, I didn't find a treasure. I found this guy called the Alchemist, and he says if at least four cities survive, he'll join my cause. Well, that's not seeming very likely right now, but that's good to know. So I can search more cities for treasures. How about this one? How about this one? Okay, that's a gem that if that city survives, I'll get extra points. Okay, that's a sword that it's going to give a bonus. Maybe it has another treasure. No. And here's a spear that's going to get a bonus. So the last thing I have to do is figure out where the barbarians are coming, and they can come anywhere that's on the edge of the board that's not oasis or fields, or crops rather. So crops are here and here, so they can't be here. Crops are here and here, they can't be here. They could be pretty much anywhere along here, or they could come in here or here or here or here. So I'm going to search these four because that sort of narrows the field the most. Oops, can't get there. Okay, so I didn't find the little cairn that marks where they're going to come over there. So they're probably coming from from somewhere along here. I'm going to search up this way. No, I didn't find it. I have two more turns. I want to decide whether I want to spend those two more turns searching for that cairn or not. I might as well. So, there's the cairn. So that cairn indicates where the barbarians are coming. They're going to come to the closest city. By Pythagorean distance. So that's this one. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Squared plus 1 squared is 26. 1, 2, 3, 4. 1, 2 is less than 26. So this is the city they're going to attack. And I'm done with my turns, but I get to do one more thing, and that is I'm going to have 10 seconds, and in those 10 seconds I can click on cities to draw population. I'm pointing at the screen, and you can't see me point at the screen, to draw population from other cities along roads to that city. And because the city has the spear, I think I'm going to defend it. I'm going to concentrate my forces at that city. So I'll do that, and it's just sucking the population out from... and also my remaining followers, and then I'll also concentrate there. So this is where the barbarians are going to travel, and here they come. Now, before we start, there's a couple hundred barbarians, and there's only like 100 odd of me in this city, and maybe there's more down here, and I have a bunch of tech though. So before we start, I find that the outcome is strongly affected by cheering. So if you want me to win, I would ask for you to cheer for my guys to please fight, fight, fight. And if you want me to lose, I would ask for you to just cheer, die, 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 and we'll just see how the combat goes. So that was a case where my technology really took care of me. And I earned the Alchemist. Yes, I earned the Alchemist. I only lost one city. And I got my Glyph of Power, and I'll get to go to the next level. And it's a new, randomly generated level, and now, he says, thank you for defending my home. I will work with your miners to help you produce more technology at a faster rate. And there's an additional mine in the mountain range. So there's these advisors that you find that give you special perks, and you have to earn them, and they stay around for a little while. And so I would continue playing the second level now with my Alchemist buddy. Oh, this probably means there's a city up here. I'm not going to play the whole second level, but you get the idea. What I would like to show you is what happens when you lose. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to start a new game. Yes, yes. Start a new game. And I'm going to start this on insane difficulty. And the other thing I'm going to do when I'm playing this game is I'm going to hold down the tab key, which is the make random moves key. And so I'm just going to basically let the computer play randomly. All right, so that was 85 turns right there.
And you can see that I've built this nice little suburban sprawl over here that kind of goes nowhere. And I've thought to expand towards this other city, but not quite hook them up. Found a bunch of treasures. I put four guys in a mine, and I didn't even get them. Oh, I'll probably get the bows before the very end. Well, you know, if not too many barbarians come, it should be fine. So I'll just, you know, put my five followers in there, and we'll... we won't speed up. Let's see what happens. Oh, look, there's a fair number of barbarians. It's okay to root for die. That's all right. All right, I'm going to speed up a little bit. Oh, I screwed that up. So here's what happens is when they sack all your cities, they come to the obelisk and you have to fight them personally. You have this number up here, which is your scarab power, and you have to use that to smite the barbarians. 1 point of scarab power smites one barbarian. If you have enough scarab power, then you survive the level. If you don't have enough scarab power, then you lose the whole game. So let's actually see if I have enough. Oh, I do have enough. Oh, no, but there's more barbarians. So that's me being defeated for not having enough scarab power. So one of the things, I want to just do this one more time because there's a mechanic that I wanted to point out that I wanted to, that I'm going to talk about later. So I'm going to do yet another one really fast on insane. And we'll just, 85 turns down the hatch. I have to click okay. Okay, so then here come the barbarians, and let's put our guys there. And I'm just going to fast forward through the whole thing and hope that I can collect correctly. Notice when... I'll just do this down as they get... Okay, watch one of the things that happens. Oh, I did find the glyph, which is good, because then I couldn't show you this mechanic. One of the things that happens when the barbarians come to attack me is the glyph that I had found. The first thing that'll happen is it'll come and it'll smite 50 barbarians. And so, like, if I lose, but there's only 50 barbarians left, or fewer, then I will, without any sacrifice of my persistent hit points, I will be able to survive the level. So that's a mechanic I wanted to point out. So we'll watch the glyph come and smite. Here comes. Zap. And then my other stuff comes. My other scarab power comes. And can't finish the game. Okay, so that's Oasis. And guess what? No high score for you. Okay. So that's Oasis, and hopefully we played Oasis. So now I'm going to talk, now that we've done a game demo, I'm going to not talk about that game, but instead talk about this concept of intuition and intellect, which is just ways of thinking about game design. So when I'm talking about intuition, I'm really talking about sort of what, you know, sort of your wisdom stat, right? I'm talking about the things that, you know, sort of like you understand that sort of come naturally in terms of game design. Things that come from life experience, things that are sort of just mysterious and creative. I know, we should have a wombat, you know, or whatever that creative spark that, you know, that comes up with ideas and sometimes just solves problems, and you don't know where these solutions come from necessarily. The intuition is mysterious, and it's creative, and it's quick and dirty, right? The ideas can come very quickly, right? But you can't really, you don't necessarily have any paper trail for the ideas, right? Intellectual process, on the other hand, is sort of based on like study and research. It's, you know, it's sort of like your toolkit that you've learned. It's very articulate. It's very analytical. You can talk very carefully about sort of like how about the intellectual process that led you to that led you to a particular decision. So in some sense, like the intellect is going with your brains and intuition is going with your gut, right? And intellectual process tends to be very slow and very precise. Like an idea that you can have that your gut produces will take a long time for your brain to necessarily come up with. And in some sense, the brain's better at analysis. Like sometimes your intellectual process can actually like explain the idea that you had intuitively. So there's a lot of discussion about these kinds of things, and often we use metaphors. And this is one of my favorite quotes from Mike Myers, the actor. Not the Halloween villain or any other Mike Myers. The intellect is a Bailey bridge built between islands of inspiration. A Bailey bridge is a particular kind of temporary bridge used in construction. And the idea is that, you know, you're on a particular island of inspiration, you're being inspired, and you need to get to another one. And you put up this temporary intellectual bridge that allows you to, you know, to get to a new place of inspiration. And then the bridge is temporary, so you take it down, right? You don't leave it up there. You don't change your process permanently to an intellectual process. You just use the intellect to get you to a new place. And that's a pretty he actually said that inside the Actors Studio, and I thought that was a pretty inspiring quote. Another metaphor I like to think of is that it's a gear ratio metaphor, that the intuition is your high gear, right? It's good at going fast. It'll get you places very quickly. And whereas the intellect is the low gear. It's good at hauling a lot of weight, and it's good and delivering a lot of power, right? And one of the points is, yeah, so it's a speed versus power kind of trade-off, right? And one of the points of that metaphor is that you need both gears, right? Like if you don't have if you're not capable of being an intuitive game designer and you want to work professionally as a game designer, then you're not going to ever ship a game because it's going to take you too long to actually come up with anything. Likewise, if you don't have an intellectual process, you're just going to get stuck. You're going to, like, you know, people talk about writer's block, and there's the equivalent thing in game design where it's just like you don't. Like if the well of ideas is dry, then what do you do? Well, you have to have an intellectual process that's going to help you. I mean, there's things you can do in your life that will help you fill the well, but like you also have to have an intellectual process that can get you out of stuck. So the name of this talk is intellect, intuition, and intellect, not intuition versus intellect. The point isn't to pit these two concepts against each other. It's to sort of talk about how these two things are sort of like yin and yang of creativity. However, intellectual stuff is easier to talk about, right? Like there. I don't know how many classes in your course catalog are how to have a good idea, right? There might be one. But again, that's balanced against like, you know, hundreds of classes that are about all kinds of intellectual stuff that people can actually talk about, right? So like when you're in kind of an academic setting where you're talking about things like game design or other kinds of pursuits, like a lot of the conversation tends to be intellectual. So I'm going to talk about a little bit about the intellectual framework that I use when I'm thinking about game design and when I'm working on game design, and it involves a sort of thing about games as software, right? And so when you have a piece of software, first you have some code, right? It's some machine instructions, and then you have a process. So Microsoft Word is like a bunch of code, and when you start Microsoft Word, you get a window and you can do stuff, right? Like Microsoft Word is some code that is used to create a process, and that window and the actual activity that you and the things that you do are that process, right? Which is separate from the code, right? And that process presumably meets some requirements, right? Like someone wrote Microsoft Word because people needed to edit documents, right, and print them and things like that. Someone wrote Internet Explorer because people needed to download porn, you know, things like that, right? Like software is written to some kind of purpose. And I think that there's a direct analogy between software, and this is showing my computer science background, and games. I think of not just computer games as software, I think of all games as software. I think of a chessboard as an abacus that runs a different program, right? So you have rules right? And those rules are, you know, like you can have a box with, that's a board game that's just full of rules, right? And it's just sitting there on the shelf full of rules. Well, it's not fun while it's on the shelf, right? Like you have to actually, in order to actually like get the benefit from the game, I mean, okay, for some of us it's fun while it's on the shelf because we're collectors, but I was looking at Warren. To actually get the benefit of the game, you actually have to take it off the shelf, right? And you have to sort of like participate in this activity. That box of contents like is instructions that tells you how to perform some kind of activity, right? And if you perform that kind of activity, like it promises you that if you follow these steps, you're going to have fun. Right? Like the game has requirements. It has aesthetic objectives that it's trying to serve. Right, so there's a one-to-one correspondence in mind between sort of like the specification of the system, the dynamic behavior of the system, and the emotion and the content, the purpose of the system, between games and software. One-to-one correspondence, and so like these three pieces are sort of the three pieces of the high-level intellectual framework that I use for game design. It's a design vocabulary. You know, we think about games in terms of their mechanics, we can think about games in terms of their dynamics, and we can think of their games in terms of the aesthetics. And so this is what I call the MDA framework, mechanics, dynamics, and aesthetics. So I changed the words now, right? And part of that is to sound pointy and academic, I'll grant. Pointy-headed and academic. But part of it is to get past all the connotational baggage, right? I want words that we can own, right? I don't want to have to argue about whether catharsis is fun, right? I don't want to have to argue about whether gravity is a rule of baseball, right? I want to have words that we can own as part of the theory and we can sort of own the definitions of. So I sort of think of these as three views of games. Like, viewing games in terms of their systemic description, viewing games in terms of their systemic behavior, and viewing games in terms of the emotional content. And this plays directly into sort of the relationship between the player and the designer, right? Like, we're over here as designer making the rules, and the player's over there having the fun. And so we're like playing this game. This is the string of that telephone, right? That tin can telephone that we are trying to communicate to the player, right? Like this is the indirect channel through which we communicate our ideas. So I want to bring that intellectual framework back to this game, Oasis, that we saw. So first, I want to talk about Oasis. Now, this talk is not a post-mortem. I'm not going to talk about like what we did right and wrong on Oasis. I'm really talking about what we were thinking when we made it. And so one of the things that I want to talk about is not what's fun about Oasis, but what we wanted to be fun about Oasis, right? So we wanted to challenge the player. We wanted to give the player interesting problems to solve, right? We wanted to create a strategic landscape for the player to explore and discover. We wanted to give the opportunity for the player to craft his own game science. And that's a term that Richard Garfield uses a lot for like sort of the science that players develop of like how to sort of like strategically like solve the game. We wanted to create an emergent narrative. We wanted to give you the sense that there was this drama that was unfolding as you were exploring, as the barbarians are coming and laying your cities to ruin, you know, that sort of like creates this tension, right, that builds towards a climax and then resolves itself, right? We wanted to fulfill a fantasy. We wanted to make the player feel like, we wanted the game to be about something. We wanted to make it feel like you were building a little empire, right? And lastly, we wanted to like have a game that looked and sounded pleasant, that was fun to play because it just had nice graphics and nice sound. So those are what we set out to do when we did Oasis. But it can't be everything, right? Because like I just described a whole lot of games, right? There's a lot of games that, you know, you could say, oh, like I could make this, take this game, and I could, you know, make, you know, Civilization, you know, or I could take this list and I could make, you know, Metal Gear Solid, maybe, I don't know. I mean, maybe not the Tiny Empire part, but there's a different fantasy, right? So like this doesn't really, this doesn't really say a whole lot about Oasis itself in terms of what we were trying to, the game that we were trying to make. So, like, in addition to all of those things, I feel like there's that a game has to kind of have what I'm calling a design thesis. It's sort of like, what is unique about this game? What is this game trying to do, or what is this game trying to explore that other games aren't trying to explore? That sort of uniquely describes this game in terms of game design. And here's the design thesis of Oasis. We wanted Oasis to be the anti-Minesweeper. Minesweeper is a game where every click is potential failure, right? Minesweeper is a game where every click you are fearing for your life, right? And every click is just a potential to lose the game, and you want to like make clicks as carefully as possible. We wanted to make a game where every click was something good, and you just needed to maximize your goodness. You just needed to reach a threshold of goodness so that the barbarians wouldn't destroy you, right? The barbarians are just that this test of how well you did, that you either pass or fail at the end. But we wanted every single click to be a choice between one good thing and another good thing. So clicking yields information, for example. But clicking is like in Minesweeper, right? In Minesweeper, making a click gives you more information and lets you make more clicks. It was that idea. But clicking is good instead of bad. Right, so many, many, many carrots. Every click is something yummy, and then there's one big barbarian horde that threatens to take away all those yummy things you picked up. Some of the carrots are sucker punches. There are some things that are good, but not as good as they seem like. Right, like so. Some of the things, like for example, when you explore the Oasis, there's like a musical tone that plays with each cell of the Oasis that you explore. And so when you find the Oasis for the first time, if you search the entire Oasis, then you get a little musical song, right, from the musical tones that are made of those individual moves. Right? And so it encourages you to like get the whole Oasis right now, even though the Oasis itself has no military value. The Oasis has value in terms of it gives you hit points that may help you survive later, but the Oasis doesn't actually itself, aside from that glyph, doesn't actually help you beat the barbarians. Right? So that's an example of like we wanted to do some things where the sights and sounds of the game cued you disproportionately about the value of some of the things that you were doing. But everything you were doing was good, right? So I want to talk a little bit about the strategic landscape. So we wanted to give you some stuff. We want to give you some stuff to explore and discover about the strategy of Oasis, right? So the player kind of starts out as a tourist of the strategic landscape, like this idea of discovery. Like, oh, what happens if I do this? Oh, if I do, you know, what happens if I do that? And eventually, yeah, you become a native. You gain mastery over the strategic landscape. Right. So one of the things is that about the Oasis is we have a map generator, right? And the map generator generates maps randomly, but according to very specific rules. Right? There are rules about what the shape of the mountains can be. There are rules about where the barbarian cairn, where the barbarians enter the game, enter. There are rules about how many cities there can be. There are rules about their population. There's rules about the shape of and location of the Oasis. And so much of the strategic landscape of the game, much of the learning of how to play Oasis is learning just the rules of this map generator. Because the more you know about how the map generator works, the more you can interpret the information of the explored squares that you have and figure out what the rest of the map is, right? You saw me using that to my advantage when I was trying to look for the cairn, right? The first thing I did was like eliminate one whole side of the board, right? So that hey, even if I don't find the cairn, I kind of know it's in this general area, so I can plan based on it being in that general area. So like knowing the map generator and knowing how how it places, for example, the cairn helps you plan, right? And the combat system is another case. Like the actual rules by which those tiny little people, you know, their little numbers go down, and how much technology helps you, and how much fighting earlier rather than later helps you, and how much the treasures help you. That little system is some place where you can explore and eventually become an expert. One of the emergent design principles of our design thesis that we arrived at was, you know, we wanted to make a game where every click was good, so we had to have this principle that there were no bad clicks. Right? So It became one of our aesthetic yardsticks, right? We said up front, there are no bad clicks. If you make a click, it gives you something good, right? We had to be very careful about what our notion of bad was, right? And our notion of bad is worth less than nothing, right? If there was a button on the board that said waste one turn, right? And just all it did was decrement your turn and wasted all your turns and wasted that turn, then any other click had to be at least no worse than that, right? Any other click had to be, if it was worse than that, than clicking that button, then we couldn't allow that click to happen in the game, right? And so, for example, when you saw me hit, hold the tab key and the player, the random AI player, made a lot of random clicks, those clicks were bad in the sense that they failed to accomplish the goal, but each click, earned the player something. It just didn't add up to the right things. Right, so a wasted click wasn't bad. Right, a wasted click was the worst worst click that was permissible. Right, that and so that was the notion of bad that we had to have, and this principle, this no bad clicks principle, killed many, many features before they even got implemented. Right, we want to do this instead of that, and we want to have an advisor that if you don't find him hurts you, or something, or an advisor that. Or a weapon that, if the barbarians sack that city, it's a weapon, but if the barbarians sack that city, they'll pick it up and they'll take it with you, which means that, clicking and discovering that weapon in a city that, you couldn't defend was a bad click, that you wanted to not do. So, there were many, many potential features that were just outright killed because they created bad clicks. And fundamentally, we failed at this objective, right? There are still corner cases and weird situations where there's a city that you know where it is, but you don't want to reveal it because the barbarians always go to the closest city, and revealing the city will change the barbarians' path in a way that you can't defend versus a way that you can. So there are still in the game, in places, some bad clicks that we couldn't get rid of, that were kind of emergent, right? So we wanted to make the game challenging. We wanted to make Oasis challenging. That was one of our aesthetic objectives. So there's lots of things about the game dynamics that are challenging. So one of the things is that there's a resource mechanic. There's these followers, and you can use them for at least two different things, right? You can use followers to build roads. You can use followers to in mines, and you can also use followers as soldiers at the very, very end of the game. So a lot of different things that you want to do, all the things you want to do are competing for your turns, your clicks, and some of them are also competing for followers, right? And so that particular decision is a source of a lot of the challenge of the game. How do I spend my turns? How do I spend my followers? And that's combined with, the randomization of the map. There's a little bit of randomization in the player, right? You're exploring, you decide whether to explore north or explore south. Right, that's a pretty much random choice, or it can be a pretty much random choice, and north gives you different information than south, and so that's going to change your experience, change two users' experience of even the same level, right? And combined with also the limited information, you can't, there's 100 squares on the board and you have 85 clicks, do the math, you can't explore the entire board, right? So you have limited information, right? And all of those things, feed into your decision of how to spend your turns and your followers. So the randomness and the limited information become this giant soup, right? This giant soup of emergent properties that make the decision of just do I click here or do I click there very complicated, right? And so the challenge kind of emerges from that soup. Like I said, so one of the things is people talk about balancing a game, balancing the difficulty of the game, and they sort of talk about it there's the question of how do you find the balance point? How do you find there's this scale of easy from easy to impossible, and somewhere there's a sweet spot that's challenging, and so the question is how do you find that point? Like, do you just play it forever and keep moving levers until you find the point? No, you just don't. You don't even try to find that point, right? This was our approach, and this is the oldest trick in the book, right? You start easy, right? If you start where the game's easy, and you just keep turning up the lever, right? You just march onward and upward, like as the game progresses, like as you go do more and more levels, play more and more levels, the game just gets harder and harder and harder and harder, regardless of what difficulty level you picked, right? And so it's just up to the player to win before the game becomes impossible to win, right? And you know, and so you still need to tune it, right? Like, you can make the velocity of this movement so fast that, like, it becomes impossible immediately and no one ever wins, right? You can make the velocity of this movement, like, so slow that it never becomes particularly hard, so it's never challenging, right? But, like, now you're tuning a first derivative instead of a zeroth derivative. You're tuning an easier quantity to tune. And this really reflects our whole attitude towards game balance at Mind Control Software. It's not about you know, finding the magic spot through playtest. It's about building systems that kind of allow the player to find the magic spot, and you know, and possibly even systems that can in real time, like, converge towards the magic spot while the player is playing, through feedback and things like that. So Oasis, we wanted Oasis to be dramatic. And look, we have an intellectual model of drama. You probably learned it in, like, junior high, and it's this, right? Like, drama is about having dramatic tension that rises towards a climax and then resolves. Maybe it's that shape, maybe it's a different shape. People, like, argue about what the shape of that curve ought to be. But it's something like that, right? And so how did we achieve that? How do we try to achieve that in Oasis, right? There's a lot of different ways, actually, right? Like, there's a lot of little arcs in the game. One of them is through the difficulty of the game. It starts easy, it builds towards hard, and it either resolves by you winning the game or it becoming impossible, right? If you look at if you just graph the number of choices the player has over the course of the game, right? At the beginning, you can explore, and you have four spaces you can explore into. As the things open up, you have more choices and more choices and more choices. But then as things start to get explored, right, and you know, things start to become clear, your choices become fewer and fewer, right, over the course of those 85 turns. And that, it just has that shape. So, in some sense, like, your decisions become increasingly more important, right? The more choices you have, like, the more important it is for you, the harder it is for you to find the right one, and the more important it is for you to find the right one. And, you know, once you have few choices, then, if you once again have few choices, then you're sort of absolved of responsibility of, like, finding the right one, because, like, you know, you just can't get far from the right one. We also have this particular flow of the game. Like, I don't know if you guys noticed, but, like, Oasis starts out as a turn-based game where you have 85 turns. And then it has this little real-time bit where, like, you have 10 seconds to do some clicking. And then it has this little time bit. And then it has this real-time but non-interactive bit where, like, guys fight and you see what happened, right? And that sort of, like, that itself creates a little dramatic arc. And I'll talk about that more. The combat. One of the things about the combat system is that, you know, because you have, as the player, have technology, right, that helps you in the fight, and the barbarians never do. Like, you very frequently, you know, like, the technology lets you overcome a numerical advantage. So you very frequently, like, get into a situation where you're losing numerically. There's just more barbarians than you, right? And then over time, your technology starts working, right? And the numerical advantage starts to shrink, and suddenly it's even. And then all of a sudden, it kind of turns, right? And now you're winning, right? Now you have the numerical advantage, and that's like the climactic moment where it, like, goes from, hey, I'm losing this, or it seems like I'm losing this, to I'm winning this. And that's kind of like an illusory trick, right? Like, we make it look worse than it is, right? And then over time, we make it look exactly like it is. And so there's a lot of different dramatic arcs sort of buried within Oasis. And some of them are authored and some of them are emergent. Like, this flow thing, we thought very carefully about, you know, how we wanted to do 85 turns and then 10 seconds and then now just watch, right? The choices thing, I want to say that we planned that perfectly, that, you know, we wanted it so that you started with a few turns and you had a few choices and had a lot, and then you had a few, but it kind of just emerged. Right? The difficulty thing, very much on purpose. The combat thing, very much on purpose. And we even tweaked the combat math to accentuate that that fact. So I want to get back to this notion of intuition and intellect. Right? I want to talk about how the intuitive design decisions we made in Oasis and the intellectual design decisions we made worked when we were creating Oasis. Generally, our day-to-day process is largely intuitive. We come up with ideas, we shoot ideas down because we think they're not right, whatever. When it comes time to like really dig things in, then we get intellectuals. Our intellectual process helped us get out of ruts. When we were stuck on a problem, when we had a game design bug or a balance problem, you know, that's when the intellectual process really helped us. It helped us communicate our objectives. Once we had that list of aesthetic objectives for Oasis that I showed you, we could actually talk about, you know, how we were meeting those and how we might want to make trade-offs between those, right? And some of our intellectual process just helped us do some tricky mathematical stuff in the game mechanics to get the things that we need. There's just some stuff that you just need to know the mathematical tricks to get it to work. I wanted to talk a little bit about how some ways in which the intellectual process and the intuitive process kind of came into conflict. And one of them was that smitey glyph feature that I showed you, right? When you lose the military fight and the barbarians come to your tower, the glyph comes and smites 50 of them. And so the motivation for that was this problem was that like all levels were either forward progress or backward progress, right? All levels, like either you got a glyph, you know, or you defeated the barbarians, or your scarab power, essentially your hit points went down, right? And there was no like region of forgiveness in the middle, and we really felt like that region of forgiveness was important because we didn't want you to feel like if you ever lost that you were just on a death spiral. Like we wanted to forgive you and let you move on. So that was the solution we proposed. We proposed, hey, maybe the glyph can do 50 points of damage as it's destroyed, right? Slay 50 barbarians as it's destroyed, you know? But we had a lot of theoretical problems with that, right? Like, we didn't want you to stall, right? That approach lets you make choices that are stalls, that let you play for survival rather than victory, and let you prolong the game, you know, in situations where probably you're on a death spiral and you should really just start over, right? And so we theoretically understood that this created an opportunity for like some undesirable behavior. And the other thing is that one of our objectives was this sucker punch, this idea that like if you explore the Oasis, you're not getting any military value. You're getting other things, right? You're getting more scarab power, which will come out, and you're getting the glyph, which you need to win, but you're not getting anything that lets you defeat barbarians. And now all of a sudden, the glyph, which is found in the Oasis, is a thing that lets you defeat barbarians. So it diminishes that thing. But it just made sense. Intuitively, it just made sense. Like it made sense that glyphs of power could smite barbarians, and it made sense that that was why you lost it when they came. So, you know, so we ended up going with it. We ended up sort of tossing the intellectual stuff out the window. Here's another example is the Pharaoh's Challenge. So the publisher asked us to create a campaign mode for Oasis. And part of the problem because one of the problems with Oasis is basically like before we created this campaign mode, like you pretty much saw the whole game, right? And so like that might be a game that you want to play for hours and hours, but you may not be convinced that it's worth $20, right? So one of the things that we had to do is we had to give you a sense that, hey, if you pay $20, not only are you going to get that game that you already saw, but we're going to give you actually a bunch of content, a bunch of different scenarios and campaigns that you get to play through that you don't get to play through in the free trial. So that became a business mandate, right? So one of the things that the intellect helped us with in here is that like when we created the campaign mode, we had this very tightly tuned game, right? And now we had to like add a bunch of stuff to it, right? So one of the things that that happened was that, like, we sort of intellectually said, all right, we've already made a really good game. If we're gonna like throw a bunch of stuff in it, we're probably gonna make a worse game, right? And then we just, we intellectually, like, rationalized that freedom. We said, that's okay with us. We already have the really good game in our like anything that expands upon it, like, probably will make it worse, but like maybe we can make games that are worse, but are just interesting variations that are just interesting. So like we went out in search of like interesting worseness, and that was okay with us, right? And one of the things that we had to do in the process of making the Faris challenge is, because hey, look, we're gonna make a worse game. We just are. Is that we relaxed the no bad clicks rule, right? We had specific in the campaign. There are specific scenarios. You can always play the classic Oasis game, which has the no bad clicks rule as best as we could get it. But there are specific places in the campaign where sometimes we said, oh, well, if we do this, it creates a bad click. Ah, we're gonna do it anyway because it's a scenario that you play once on one level. You know, and it's a quirky variant, and yeah, maybe there's a bad click, but that's okay. You can if you're bothered by bad clicks, you can always play the sort of pure game. So I wanted to talk about the sort of level flow. We have this idea of there's three phases of the game, right? There's that exploration and building phase, right? And then there's that 10-second troop deployment phase, which is in real time. So there's the turn-based game, and then there's the real-time game, and then there's the non-interactive game, right? And so, like anyone who makes games or played games will tell you that you can't have a game that is all three of turn-based and real-time and interactive, right? Like that almost never happens, right? Like pick what kind of game you are. Geez, like I don't want to have to worry about spending 10 seconds. Really, spends 10 seconds is a lot of time, but for that thing. But were we nuts? You know, so like the conventional wisdom said that like we were crazy to make a game that like had all three of these elements, right? But guess what? Conventional wisdom is largely intuitive, and we really felt like we had a really good intellectual framework that explained it, right? That the exploration and building phase was turn-based because it needed to be more forgiving to be less tense. Right, and then the deployment phase, we really wanted to give you a little time pressure to ramp up the tension. And then the battle phase was the climax of the level, right? And it was okay that it was non-interactive because it was the climax of the level. And so, hey, this is exactly like a golf game, right? You have the completely real, the completely turn-based. Fiddle all you want, picking your aim, choosing a club, do whatever you want, take all the time you want. Kind of phase of the shot, and then you have the real time. You know, you must do the clicks right, or you must swing the Wiimote right. You know, swing meter part, and then you have the totally non-interactive. I'm going to watch the ball fly and see what happens, right? Part, and you know, we can sort of thematize, and that's exactly what we're doing in Oasis, right? We can thematize that, right? Like where you have this little thing where you have a planning phase, right? That's very forgiving. Plan all you want. Then you have an execution phase where there's a little bit of pressure, right? There's a little bit of like, let's see if you can actually execute on your plan, right? And then there's a result phase where you actually, you know, where you just see, it's just interactive and you're non-interactive and you're just watching the result. I mean, it might not be non-interactive. Like, this particular arc, like, happens all the time, right? Like, I'm gonna jump over this chasm and get that power up so I can shoot that guy. Let's see if I can do it, right? That happens in all games. So I think we felt like we were on solid intellectual ground having those three phases. So one of the things that, here's another example, is the idea of difficulty coupling. Originally we just had like, hey, there was a level number, and the level number was how hard the game was, the level was, and hey, succeed or fail, you go to the level of the next number, right, and the game's a little harder. And the difficulty level is just what level number you started on. You know, if you wanted to play on a hard difficulty level, you started on level 21. It was exactly like Tempest, right? Like, I don't know if you guys have played, remember Tempest, but, well, I don't know if you remember Tempest, but if you played Tempest, like, you know, when you start, you know, you can say, hey, I want a harder game, so I'm just going to start on a later level, right? And so, like, that was sort of just, like, a fun aesthetic thing that we intuitively knew we wanted. Right, that just there was one scale of difficulty that was level number, and the overall game difficulty was just, hey, where in that progression are you inserting yourself at the start? And just empirically, it just didn't work out, right? Like we couldn't preserve that and give ourselves enough tuning freedom. Like, you know, like, oh, if insane is level 31 and a player starts on easy and like flails around for 30 levels, like he probably never wants to be like doing the things that the insane player is expected to do. So like we just couldn't get it to work. So we changed it so that all levels start at 1 and every level has a different curve of how level number maps to hardness, right? And once we did that, it bought us all kinds of tuning freedom. All of a sudden like we could actually think of the curves as being different. Like the easy one actually has a different like exponent, you know. It's a linear curve instead of a quadratic curve and things like that. And so that bought us a lot of freedom to actually like tune the different difficulty levels differently. So here's what we did in this talk. We looked at Oasis. We discussed intellectual and intuitive game design. We presented that mechanics, dynamics, aesthetics framework that I talked about. And then we looked at Oasis in terms of that. And then I discussed a few moments of like how intuitive process and intellectual process like came to manifest themselves as we made Oasis and the moments in which they came into conflict. So at this point, I will open it up to questions. You can find these slides at my website, which is the8kindsoffun.com. So, do we have any questions about this talk? Go ahead.
Okay. How did you gauge what was the measuring stick of the level of difficulty for each level? You know, how did you tweak the curve?
How did we tweak the curve? That's an excellent question. I mean, I think the curve was actually defined by the actual lever was the number of barbarians that came, pretty much exclusively. There were a couple other things like size of the oasis. Like in the easier difficulties, the oasis was smaller, and so once you found it, it was easier to find the glyph. But largely, the main variable, the main lever that we pulled to make the game harder was the ratio of the starting population of all your cities that we knew from generating the map to the barbarian population that was eventually going to come. And that ratio was the main indicator of difficulty. And the difficulty curve was determined, difficulty curve had a few different coefficients in it. It had a coefficient that was linear in the level number. It was a coefficient, I believe, that was quadratic in the level number. And it had a coefficient that was, I believe, linear in the number of glyphs that you had. And it had a constant. So it was an expression of four terms, and you could for each difficulty level tune those terms independently, right? So for example, on easy difficulty level, I'm pretty sure like the per glyph constant was zero. Like no matter how many glyphs you got, you didn't get any more difficulty. Whereas on insane, that constant was pretty high. Like or I think even actually on normal, that constant was pretty high. We tuned it so that the per level difficulty wasn't very good. But as you started to get too close to winning the game, then we started to ramp up the difficulty, right? Like you could stall around and go through a lot of levels without making a lot of progress. But as soon as you started making progress, that's when we ramped up the difficulty. So yeah, good question. Go ahead. Yeah, the time imperative is much more clearer on higher difficulty levels. Like on higher difficulty levels, there are circumstances where like 10 seconds actually, you know, is not enough time to do all the stuff that you want. In particular, on higher difficulty levels, there are, and here's another lever, there are multiple cairns, and the barbarians like come in multiple waves from multiple directions. And so you actually need to reinforce multiple places and think about how much you want in each, because you know there's a certain conservation of resource there. So like actually getting all the clicks in that you want in 10 seconds like actually is, at the highest difficulty level, you know, a factor. But even at the lowest difficulty level, we wanted that sense of, like, we just wanted the sense of impending doom. Right, like we could have made it totally turn-based. We could have made it. We could have said like click until you're done, and then click the done button, and then when you click the done button, we could have then done a countdown. Right, 10, 9, 8. Like here they come. Ramp up the music and have them start. But we chose to have that here they come moment while you were doing something, right? In part so you didn't feel like your time was being wasted. Back there.
What games would you consider to be the most direct inspiration for Oasis?
What games were the most direct inspiration for Oasis? I have to say Minesweeper and Civilization. Oh, gosh. Just those two. There are probably others. I'd have to think about it. You know, I mean, inspiration isn't always obvious, you know? Go ahead. I think the anti-Minesweeper was the original spark. Now, this game was, I wasn't the sole designer on this. It was a collaboration with myself and Andrew Leaker. And basically, the original idea, the original concept is his, but I think that was the spark. I think it was like it's frustrating to me that like every click is a moment of peril in Minesweeper, and I want to make it something sweeter that's, you know, like makes you feel like you can just click, you know, and it won't kill you immediately. Go ahead. Did we use any tangible metrics to measure the success or failure of the difficulty curve? I'd like to say that at most we counted rate of success, rate of failure. We didn't like build a giant database or have the thing beam your results back up to the mothership, but we sort of collected. We would play games and report to each other. You know, I won on level number blah. You know, with this curve, or I won on, you know, and you know, or I, you know, so we would look at level number when you finished. We would look at rate of success, you know, and things like that. And those were the things that we were looking at. Did we do good rigorous measurement of those things? I wish I could say that we did, but we mostly did somewhere between anecdotal and rigorous measurement of those things. Warren. Okay.
How long was it from first concept to first playable?
Okay.
What was your playtest strategy? Did you use blind testers every week? Did you, you know, send it to all of your friends hypothetically? Did you just play yourselves?
Right.
And was there a period where did you use any like paper prototypes? I mean, you're a board game guy.
Right. Actually, the truth of the first question is interesting because it happened without me. And you know, upon further autobiographical examination, like more things will come out. But Oasis was part of the inspiration for me to leave Visual Concepts. Andrew had this idea. He sort of fleshed the idea out, and he told some friends about it. And some friends said, I really want to play that game, so I want to give you money just to make it. I don't want to publish it or anything. I just want to give you enough money so that you have enough time to make it. And Andrew said, I can't take your money. But that inspired him to go and spend like a Thanksgiving weekend and make a Java prototype, initially of Oasis, which I played. And that was the part of the inspiration for me to leave Visual Concepts. In terms of, you know, testing, that was the second question? One of the big things that we did was obviously send to our friends, but in later phases what we did was we just had a huge open beta. We just like, we would just like put it up on a website for anyone to download and had a forum where people could like send, you know, give us their thoughts, and you know, we would tune and send new versions out and stuff like that, and it worked great. We had like, I think we had like, you know, we were a tiny indie company and we had like, you know, 5,000 free beta testers or something, you know, so that, you know, not all of them vocal, but it really helped us a lot in finding some stuff. Like, people, you know, did all kinds of crazy, like, I don't want to win the game, I just want to get lots of score, so I'm going to play on easy and like play for 90 levels straight, never getting a glyph, kinds of, you know, stuff. Any others? Go ahead. An example of a bad click in the campaign mode was there was a scenario where you could be in a scenario where one city had the plague, and it was fine so long as you didn't connect that city to any other city by roads. If you connected that city to any other city by roads, then all of those cities like would have the plague, and their population would drop to 10, basically making them basically destroyed. So that was a case where, like, if you, and that was a real hard one for people because, you know, like, you're just natural, strategic, it's the game trains you, connect all your cities, and when you make that one click that connects all your cities, like, to the plague city, then, like, you basically lose the level. So that was an example of that was probably the most egregious example of a bad click in the campaign. Back there. Oh, yes. We didn't actually do a lot of paper. I don't know if we did a lot of paper prototyping for this. We did an original Java prototype that was very low budget. And I don't know, like, there may have been some paper prototyping early in the process, but it did not survive, certainly. We're big fans of that, but it didn't really, it's such a small game. That's the thing, is that like paper prototyping is most valuable when it's like a huge cost differential, right? Like right now at Mind Control, we're working on a lot of games where like, and we have a pretty good engine and we can like, you know, we can prototype a real game, a real little video game in a day or two. So like, why wouldn't we, you know? I just wanted to make Warren do that with his head. any other questions, comments? You there. How did we decide on the grid size and the number of turns? That's an excellent question, and also happened. It was decided once at the very beginning, and it never changed, and it never needed to. Really? Yep, like, you know, but fundamentally, it was 100 squares and not enough turns to see them all. And, you know, 185 was in that original Java prototype, and it was in throughout the entire game, and we just tuned around that arbitrary choice. I actually did the engineering on the final version, and you know, there's all kinds. You know, the code is very abstract, so like, you know, like in theory you can like flip it to 20 by 20 really easily, but we never actually experimented with that as a lever for the campaign mode, in part because it's harder to render, you know, like the assets are set up at 1:1 pixel ratio, right? Because it's a 2D game, and it's just, we'd have to do new assets to make it a different tile size. Any other? Go ahead.
You mentioned the campaign mode as a request from the publisher.
Right.
With other casual games, have you seen other demands on those games that are outside of the core game content, like social content, social dynamics, communication?
Have I seen other constraints on like that are sort of outside of the game? I mean, certainly. Publishers are always pushing all kinds of stuff, right? I mean, that's just the reality of working with a publisher. For example, here's another thing that a publisher asked us to do. A publisher asked us to hook up their technology, which allows you to share your high scores over the internet with all other players of Oasis, right? And they that was one of their little technological shticks that all of their games had, and they demanded that we use it. I actually think it makes Oasis worse. There are people who disagree with me on that, but I actually think that one of the charming things about this game is that you can sort of play it your own way and not worry about what other people halfway around the world are doing. And at the moment that, you know, there's sort of like this global comparison of all people, then all of a sudden, like, your sense of freedom to do that sort of diminishes. And so, hey, that's another example in the very same game of people sort of making sort of external demands on the game that aren't necessarily even in its interest so much as like the interest of the business that they're running. All right.
Why not publish the game in Java?
That's a good question. We didn't really feel comfortable with Java as a toolset. The real answer is that the Java that has a wide install base is kind of a crappy language. If you want to have the advantage of the wide install base, it pretty much means you're using Java 1.1. And we weren't willing to do that. We also thought that we could just make the game more polished, faster, and just prettier by doing it in C++. Partially because, hey, that's our background, right? But certainly, like being able to write closer to the metal and being able to write, wacky direct 3D code, like made it easier for us to do some of the things that we did in that game, like the zoom when there's fighting, and Java 1.1 just wouldn't have made that easy. Go ahead.
I have two questions.
Go ahead.
This month's Spector game developer, the Crackdown team mentioned using a difficulty selection menu, like your game did, and they said that they had problems with it. They could see them early on with viewers coming in and rejoicing at normal proving too easy for them or something like that.
Right. Right. Oh yeah, we had lots of. We certainly had problems with that. We did have an unlock mechanism eventually. The question is like, is there a problem with the difficulty selection where like people the first time they're making an uninformed choice fundamentally, right? Like so we did have a difficulty unlocking mechanism where we actually have a tutorial and the tutorial starts mandatory, and then I believe we had easy and normal. Those were your choices, and you had to play. You had to play a particular scenario in normal before you unlocked hard, and played through hard before you unlocked insane, and that's how we handled it. And we gave you the one choice between easy and normal, and and we didn't worry about the people. We didn't worry about the people who found normal too easy because we gave them a gift for finding normal too easy, which is a harder difficulty level. At the end, they earned that unlock. So. How are we doing on time, Warren?
We should probably stop and
all right.
Take a little break. We'll wrap up with a couple more questions. I'm not going to get to anything today. Okay.
Oh, that's too bad.
Break.
So we are desperately short of time. I'm going to pass on a lot of the questions I was going to ask and start out by just going through each game, looking for an anecdote. First thing comes to mind. Okay, Ultima Underworld.
My one contribution to the game was there were fishing poles and there were poles and there were thread, and I suggested that you should be able to take a pole and some thread and make a fishing pole. That was pretty much my major contribution to the game. And when the demo came out, the one level demo that didn't have a fishing pole in it, and some reviewer discovered that you could take the pole and the thread and make the fishing pole, they called the creators of the game hyper intelligent beings from Jupiter. And so
and that's the power of emergent gameplay
right there.
It can make you a hyper intelligent being from Jupiter. Underworld 2.
That was a
way. Was your first game?
That was my first real game. I did the spells. I did the ice caves. That was my only level design experience ever. Really, that was my entire level design career. I did the ice caves, and I did them by holding down the mouse and scribbling. Go on.
System Shock.
Some of my art might still be in the game. I think that word "side" might be me. Edited in.
I have a specific question.
Go ahead.
Ask. Okay, System Shock was the first time at Looking Glass anyway. It felt like the team mushroomed,
right,
and things got much more specialized. So someone owned the combat system.
Basically. Right, right,
there was
right.
Lots
right.
of like big group meetings to argue about how systems should work,
right.
And then one person actually owned sort of the execution.
Sure, sure.
So how did that change the dynamics of that, you know, argumentative MIT Looking Glass culture, and how did that affect the ultimate game, the game at the end of the day?
Well, I think it made it more contentious, definitely, because now people had territory that could be horned in on, right? As opposed to just sort of collective ownership of the game. So I definitely think that, yeah, that was a little bit... That made it more contentious, definitely. A lot of the stuff that I did for System Shock was like the... Pretty much, I did the code for pretty much everything you see on the screen, like all the user interface stuff, except for the 3D world. This was sort of the Microsoft Word user interface. Like, we like thought that if we gave everything a gadget on the screen, like up on the top left there, that's the middle, the guy, that's your pose and lean-o-meter. You can crouch by clicking on that guy into the crouched position, and you can grab him and drag him to lean left and right. And there's an eye, there's a viewpoint position meter where you can grab and look up and down. And I forget what the other thing is, but like we thought that yeah, everything on had to have an on-screen user interface, or else no one would figure out how to do it. And then there was a terrible help screen that had like boxes and arrows pointing to every frickin' thing on the screen, and it was just like terribly daunting, you know. And then Doom came out, and there was nothing on the screen, you know. And we were like, oh well, maybe.
Yeah, I've already bagged on the UI for.
Yeah, no, I mean it was just yeah, it was just the perfect counterexample in System Shock.
What did you do on Flight Unlimited? I have no memory of you working on this.
I worked on mostly stuff not related to the flight sim. I worked
Excellent.
On...
Oh, sorry. No.
but in this game, you can get towed into air. If you're a glider, you can get towed into air by another plane. And I like did the recording of one of the tow... planes, that flight, that canonical flight that takes you into the air. And so in one of the versions of the game, I am credited as a pilot.
Excellent. Go on. Terra Nova.
I got kicked off of that project, actually, because I was the contentious guy who said, you know, we have been working on this for 4 years, and it's not good yet. And they didn't appreciate that. And yeah, there was a big climactic fight with Dan Schmidt where he was the project leader. And he asked me to implement a feature, and I refused because I believed that feature should not be implemented under any circumstances by anyone. And like, it was only until he threatened to assign it to someone else and have them do it that I grudgingly agreed to do it. And that was shortly before I was kicked off the team, because I was a bad influence and a naysayer. And you know, hey, guess what? I was.
In retrospect, you were also right.
I was also kind of right.
The
feature was that you could use control click to pop up menu of things that you could command your AI to do, command your AI squad mates to do. So it was just yet another user interface it was shift click or control click, yet another user interface for bossing your squad mates around. Yeah.
Thief. Now, okay, so you have to talk about, you know, ACT-REACT object systems, that sort of stuff.
I did the entity system for Thief, which is basically the underlying code system whereby designers can specify the behaviors of objects in the game. And we took this wacky approach where basically all of that, instead of like writing it as a literal C++ class hierarchy, we wrote a system that like simulated C++ class hierarchy. So the designers basically could, in a tool, like edit like, you know, a skeleton lord is a subclass of skeleton, which is a subclass of undead, which is a subclass of creature, and like navigate all those things and attach properties at every level. And it worked out great. In fact, last year at a GDC, I was at a GDC talk where some Unreal guys were bragging about like, you know, some cool thing that they did that was this type hierarchy for sounds or textures or something, so that like the same tool that you use for editing properties of objects you use for textures. And I was like, that's an awesome idea. I'm glad I did it in Thief 10 years ago.
And that's a hugely influential idea, actually. Right. I mean, it's changed the way Ion Storm worked, Midway Austin works, Junction Point works. And when applied appropriately, it really is a critical tool in getting that sort of semi-emergent sort of gameplay that we all know and love.
Right. I mean, it's kind of stuff that everyone takes for granted almost now, but yeah. it was pretty spectacular back then.
Yeah. System Shock 2, weird project with like irrational
with the wrong art, glass. I would point what? Out.
Oh no.
That's
okay, sorry. That's what I get for cutting and pasting slides week to week. Right. We'll move on. Let's not talk about System Shock 2.
Let's talk about
it. Okay. All right. With the wrong art.
That's the in some ways
sort of like the website for this class, which has the wrong art.
In some ways, it's my favorite Looking Glass game because it's the one I contributed to least creatively. Like, it's the one that, you know, I was just in a technical role, and I didn't have really much input at all into the game design, so it's the one that I'm distant enough from that I can, like, actually play as a player and enjoy. So,
let's move on to more other things. Thief 2.
I wrote one line of code for Thief 2.
Excellent. Sports games. got an anecdote about this?
I learned a lot. You know, the thing that frustrated me about working on sports games is that everyone wanted to mimic television. And that, they didn't want to give you the sports experience. They wanted to give you the televised sports experience with the commentator and the overlays and the camera angles and, you know, that stuff. No one was interested in really the in-stadium sports experience or anything like that while I was there. And so, really, I'm interested in the ways in which games aren't like television. That was frustrating for me. That said, I learned a ton working on sports games. It was like, you know, it was like a really, really big growth experience for me as a console game programmer. So,
And then Oasis, I think we've talked about that. Do you want to add anything?
Oasis, you know, I was having some trouble at Visual Concepts. I was trying to make original games. Their idea of an original game was on a movie license. Oasis is the game that I saw the prototype of, and I decided that it was worth me taking an $80,000 pay cut to make that game. So, yeah.
Actually, you know, yeah. There are a lot of people who take pay cuts to live out their dreams in the game business. Be aware of that.
Yeah.
Field Commander, PSP, huh?
PSP, kind of an interestingly architected piece of hardware, to put it politely. You know, that was a weird project in that, like, it was half the team was Sony working in San Diego, and half the team was Mind Control, or a third, really, of the team, maybe a fourth quarter of the team, was Mind Control working in San Rafael, and the rest was Sony working in San Diego. I did end up flying down to San Diego a lot and sitting in a cube and writing code in San Diego. You know, it's a perfectly good little Advance Wars clone.
Stomping Grounds.
Stomping Grounds, when we submitted it to the IGF, I insisted that it be called Andrew Leaker's Stomping Grounds because it was kind of Andrew's vanity project that he was devoting a lot of resources to, and I just wasn't sure that, and I sort of wanted to live or die with his name on it.
Re-release it as Michael Vick's Stomping Grounds.
Yeah. Oh, great.
Okay, anyway.
There was another game that I was prototyping that I was too lazy to write the online multiplayer code for, and so instead I found some code that lets you hook multiple mice up to the computer, and
he's not kidding.
And just play multiplayer on the same computer. And then we said, you could probably do cool stuff with this. And so we made a bunch. We had a spurt of like prototyping games that used multiple mice, and one of them was the prototype I did, and one of them was a failure called Red vs. Blue, which is a popular game. Another one was an RTS called Bubble Symphony, which is kind of interesting. One of them was this game, R, which we just released on our website. And basically, your mouse cursor is the wind, and everyone has a pirate ship and a mouse cursor, and you use your wind to blow your ship around, and that's how you steer your ship, and you click to shoot the cannons. And it's a cute little game. You know, really, we should do the online multiplayer because that's what would make it an actual product.
Okay. And that, unless there's something I've left out?
No, I mean, there's other little casual games. I worked on an educational first-person shooter to teach pre-algebra. That's one of the things Mind Control did. Learn math or die trying. coming to a school near you, you know, this semester.
Man, I want to play that.
It's actually kind of cool. I mean, except it's made on Torque.
Okay. So now we're in the lightning round.
All right.
I'm going to mention a couple of things, and you tell me the first thing that comes to mind. Board games, electronic games, how much do you have to unlearn moving from one to the other? How much translates from one to the other?
Well, in the board game to online to digital game direction, I would say all of it. I mean, I see play as a continuum, and like the rising tide raises all boats, right? Like I don't see like that there's I don't buy the argument that like you have to unlearn, you know, game design to design for digital games. Game design is designed within constraints, and you know, if it's board games and or if it's sports or if it's I actually really want to talk like do a design session with the NFL to work on the overtime rule. Like that's like one of my dreams. Another one of my retirement dreams is to get a like an adjunct professor position at a university where I could start an intramural sports league to play basketball using the original rules.
Ooh.
And then every year evolve them forward and see if they go in a different direction. Like that's like that's one of my dreams.
That's awesome. How important is it to have programming ability to become a game developer?
To become a game developer, I mean, it's not that important
for
artists.
Designer. Let's say designer.
To become a game designer, I think it's very important. I think like games, you know, earlier I talked about how games, like in their formal structures, are just analogous to software. All games. Chess is an abacus that runs a different program. And like, if you don't have a basic understanding of at least procedural logic in the abstract, I don't mean that you need to be a master at typing braces and semicolons, but if you can't get that procedural logic down, I think that that's going to really limit you as a game designer.
What else do you need to know to become a game designer?
I mean, I think
what should you study? I mean, let's put this in the context.
I mean, I think that there's lots of psychology that you need to know, and if you ask Gabe Newell, that's all you need to know. But lots of psychology. I think there's just some engineering principles that are valuable. In addition to programming, I think that there's lots of math that's valuable. I think game theory is a little bit valuable, the mathematical concept, but I think that there's other kinds of math, you know, probability, for example, that are more valuable. Really, I think it's just be educated, you know, be someone with a broad, you know, education in the, you know, classical liberal arts, those
yes.
seven, you know.
I didn't prompt him for that.
Yeah, I mean, you just be educated is the thing.
Okay, favorite games. Board game and or electronic, your choice.
Digital, I would have to go with Pikmin, XCOM UFO Defense, Star Control 2. I might have to put in a shout out for Archon. Although Mail Order Monsters also a favorite, got nothing. Pokemon got nothing on Mail Order Monsters, and there I think there were others, but I may have to stop there. Board games, Go, got to play the classics, Euphrates and Tigris. I'm really liking Kalis. I don't know if that'll last. These are all Euro games, well except for Go. Those are top okay. three. Yeah.
So let me roll right to names and concepts. Reiner Knizia.
Like crazy, super well. I forget what the word is, but he's made more games than anyone else.
German and board game designer.
German board game
math
designer.
Math guy.
German board game designer, math PhD. Like if you don't know who he is, he's a massively prolific is the word, and you know you must. You must play his games, especially Lord of the Rings, The Confrontation. And though, I mean, for most of his games, the fiction is wafer thin. Like, that's his big weakness, is that, you know, he just makes a game and then he dips it in some sauce and he's done.
Paul Neurath.
Reason I'm here. Put it like,
there you go.
There you go.
Brutal Countdown.
Brutal Countdown is a game I learned from Warren, which is a little it's a little game for counting the score, for determining the winner of a game that you've played. Particularly a game that involves money, for example, where the goal is to make the most money. Like you say, everyone put in $5,000 or lose the game, you know, of the money you've earned. Everyone put in a second $5,000. And it's just this little ritual that, like, adds drama. Like it makes it easier because you're not all counting and you know, it's like it's procedurally pleasant, but it's also it adds little extra like denouement to that game that you just played.
Everything's narrative, and Mark has embraced the ritual more than anybody else.
Chris Hecker is the one who named it Brutal Countdown, to my knowledge. Is that correct?
Is correct.
Okay.
Rock, paper, scissors.
It's funny. Rock, paper, scissors is brilliant. Ready, Aim, Fire is the multiplayer rock, paper, scissors invented by Wizards of the Coast.
We should explain that to everybody. So we memorialize that.
Ready, Aim, Fire. We could play it in this room. We won't. But multiplayer rock, paper, scissors. When you say fire, you have three choices. You can shoot someone, you can shoot the air, or you can shoot yourself. This is a game invented by Wizards of the Coast to determine who gets to go first in the next game. And basically, if you get shot, you're out. But if you shoot yourself and someone else shoots you, then you're not out and they are. And you can see how it degenerates to rock, paper, scissors in the two-player case. And you just play until there's one person standing. It's interesting. There's an interesting difference between rock, paper, scissors and even odds, right? Even odds is, we each pick a number of fingers, usually, and one person's evens and one person's odds. I'm trying to make the sum even, and you're trying to make the sum odd. And as a decision-making process, that's a better game because there's no ties, right? But sort of as a strategic test of wills, it's a worse game. And that, like, as Kyle Boward would say, is one of the great mysteries of the human mind.
Okay. Simulation and emulation.
Simulation.
In 30 seconds or less.
Simulation and emulation. Simulation is, I throw an object and there's a Newtonian simulator behind it, that carries the object through time and space. That's a simulation. Emulation is I click on the doorknob and the door opens because there's a system that simulates the physics of every molecule in the doorknob turning, but because there's simply a rule that says when clicked, door opens. Right. Both are appropriate. Like in fact, at the last E3, and I can just say the last E3, there was a Wii game, I think it was Elibits, where they were showing I saw someone trying to turn a doorknob by using the Wiimote, and it just had little arrows on the doorknob saying turn the door, and they couldn't get the doorknob open because they were trying to simulate the doorknob, and it's like I don't need a rich doorknob turning experience in my video games. I can get that in the real world pretty well.
Embedded and emergent narrative.
Embedded and emergent narrative. That's just sort of the idea of embedded narrative being the traditional author narrative. It's like, I'm going to make a game that tells this story, and I'm going to have a cutscene before the level and a cutscene after the level, and the cutscenes are the story I'm going to tell versus the story that, let's say, you're trying to finish the final trying to get to the final battle of XCOM UFO Defense, and you've assembled your elite squad of XCOM UFO Defense guys, and you're loading them onto the ship, and you realize that there's an empty space in the ship, and then you look around and you realize that one of your elite squad was injured in the last fight, and you'd have to wait a month for him to heal, if you want him to go in the final battle. So you can't do that. What you have to do is go to your other base, which is your training base, with the non-elite guys, and you have to comb through their stats and find the best one, and as you're putting him on the ship to send him to the final battle, you say, suit up, son, you're going to Mars. Right? And that's not something that anyone authored, right? It's just something that game designers were kind enough to allow to happen, right? Because it wasn't a Zelda game where they script every single possible puzzle, that will be solved in exactly the way they intend. It's, there's just this soup of events and outcomes from which narratives can emerge, and that's the idea.
I can't think of a better place.